Tony Bruno Show.
You know me, I've been around forever.
I know him.
Are you ready? Are we rolling? Can you hear me now?
Yep, ready?
All right, here we go.
Three, two, one.
No one can stop me now.
Here he is, the godfather of sports radio. Here's Tony Bruno.
Ah, yes, kids, it is a What Up Wednesday. And as I just mentioned a few moments ago on the world-famous LFG show, yes, I am now the presumptive king of afternoon sports talk radio on the East Coast and all over the world, depending on which time zone you listen in. And it's a word, Robin, that we really don't use that often, presumptive.
No.
I mean, I don't presume anything or assume anything. We will explore today the difference between presume and assume. Do you know the difference, Robin?
I do not.
That's actually why we're here.
I do know that assume makes an ass out of you and me. I don't know.
That's a good one. I don't even that's a great poll because we didn't rehearse this, Robin.
Oh, yeah. Thank you very much.
Assume makes an ass
out of you and me.
Out of you and me. I got to start the show. I didn't even know that one, and I know pretty much all of these silly sayings from back in the day.
You've never heard that?
I've never
How
heard
is that,
that
even
used.
Possible?
See, that's what you learn. As long as we've been together 16 years, but you learn something about your significant other every day. Sometimes what you learn, you're like, I wish I didn't know that. But in this case, this is actually good knowledge, and that's what we love on the show. It is the Wednesday, March 6th edition, and I just saw something that I cannot believe. That even though the elections were all yesterday, right?
Mm-hmm.
We know that, and I'm not going to get into the elections. You know what happened. You went out, you voted, you did your thing, and now we know the results. Except one thing. I just saw that in California, they can still count votes for like another 15 days.
What?
I'm not making this up. I just saw it before we came on here.
How long has that been going on?
I guess it's the mail-in. I guess the mail's running slowly out on the West Coast. And so if you put in a mail-in vote, they can still count it. I want to find the actual legitimate, it's a real story. I'm not making this up. And it's not one of these fake hoaxes on social media. I actually saw this a few moments ago. And, you know, I wanted to make sure we got on the air in time. So I didn't want to, because I've got so many stories we're talking about today. So we'll get to that. And people who in California listening, you know what I'm talking about. Because they obviously tell you the rules, you know, when you're voting. So anyway, whatever you did, you voted. Super Tuesday is over, and it was not so super for some people. And the big story is Nikki Haley, after winning one state out of the 15 up for grabs yesterday in the Republican primary, basically pulled the plug on her campaign today. So that's really the big news. All the other stuff is people crying and moaning and whining about whether they lost or won. And I leave that up to the political talking heads and all the heads in boxes that deal with that 24/7. But meanwhile, we've got all kinds of stuff today, Robin. We'll get you up to date on basketball, the NBA. There's a high school basketball outrage from New Jersey that's getting a lot of national attention. And it has nothing to do with the kids this time. It has nothing to do with storming the court, which we've seen a lot.
Mm-hmm.
It has to do with one team getting screwed by officials. And a lot of people say, well, my team got screwed after they lose. But there is actual video of this game last night. And there's no doubt about it of what happened. We'll play the video. And it wasn't on TV or anything. It was a courtside. It was somebody on the floor videotaping the game. And it showed the final free throw made on one end. And then the other team down, which was, I forget the other team. I'll get the video and pull it up. Camden was one of the two teams. And it was another team from New Jersey playing for a high school championship last night. And there were like 1,000 people in the building. Great game. And then the last shot goes up with 0.3 seconds left on the clock, and you can see it. And, you know, in high school gyms, they don't have that red.
Shall we play it now?
Do we have the video? Okay, you have it? Did I send it to you?
No, I'm going to have to find it really
quick. Okay, I was
going to. You're talking about it.
Yeah, because, you know, again, it's not a national story, but it actually is because Yahoo Sports, Dan Wetzel's all over it. Even Dick Vitale commented on it. And now, you know, we're in championship week in college basketball, and I'm not one to rip officials, But this is one of those cases where the people complaining are not just sour grapes, you know, lose, go home, get over it. These people who are complaining have a legitimate excuse to complain. And there are writers from all over the country talking about this. I mentioned Dan Wetzel from Yahoo Sports wrote a column on it, a writer up in New Jersey. What was his name, Rob? And I'd see
Steve Politi.
Steve Politi, who writes for a New Jersey newspaper, one of the top New Jersey newspaper. So what did he do? He wrote, and he was pretty pissed off. Do we have Steve's quote?
It's Manasquan. So
Manasquan.
Manasquan?
Manasquan. So it was what? Camden versus Manasquan High School.
And from all video accounts, the original person who posted this was Brandon Gould.
And he was on the floor.
And he was on the floor.
Underneath the basket where Camden had made a free throw in the final seconds. And then there was not very much time left. So Manasquan gets the basketball, goes all the way down to the floor, passes it off. And then this kid hits the shot from the baseline.
Right.
Not that far away. He hits the shot and it goes in. And you'll see it. So here's the rebound put back. Now that's from one angle. But that's the kid putting it back. And it goes in before the game ends.
Okay.
And the officials, there's the other angle from the floor. You have to show that from the other way. So you look at the clock, right? You look up, it's 46:45, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then 0.3 seconds left, and you can see the ball in the air.
Yes.
Against the backboard. If you're watching us, not you'll watch the video.
And now I'm going to do the next photograph where you can see the next frame, and you can see...
Yeah, this is like
the
Zapruder
film. In. And you can see at the bottom here, you can see there's 0.6 seconds.
Yeah, before he takes the shot. But the bottom line is, you know, and in college, in high school gyms, they don't have the red light that goes around the scoreboard.
Right.
You know, it doesn't even, it says home and away. So it's not, you know, like a professional gym or even a big-time college gym where they have the team's names up there. It's home and away. And so Manasquan gets the ball, and the kid hits the jumper with 0.36 seconds left. That's when it went through the net, not when the game ended. So it goes through the net, and it was clearly good. And then the officials confer, and they wave it off and said that Camden won the game.
So here's an actual larger
play the video, though.
That's a little bit longer. And they wave, but the officials wave off the shot. Okay, this is the right one.
This is the video from the other end. So you'll see the Camden kid make the free throw at the close end of the court where this film, the one I saw, was shot.
Okay.
So he makes the free throw to put Camden up, I think to tie the game, if I'm not mistaken. Or Camden was up by one. That's what it was, with the free throw by Camden. And then the kid from Manasquan, they get the ball down the floor, and then with 3 seconds left, it's as clear as day. There's no debating this. There's no, we don't know if it was due to time. We can see it. Everybody in the building saw it. Everybody who was there. Even media people, even Dick Vitale commented on this, that it's a travesty. And we don't know, I'm not saying the officials were crooked. I don't know what happened, but they conferred, and then they decided that the shot was not good, and basically Camden won the game, and Manasquan was screwed. I think we can all agree that's the case here, right?
Okay.
Is there any doubt that the ball goes in?
So we're watching it. This is a free throw.
Now here they come down, and they get the ball down quickly, pass it off, and there it is. No, that's then the rebound, and the kid puts it right off the glass, and it's good. And you can see the Manasquan kids are going crazy. But the officials confer, and then they wave it off. Yes, this video has been paused more than the Fast Times at Ridgemont High pool scene. There's no, and obviously the result wasn't as satisfying for anybody except the Camden kids. You know what I mean?
everybody think that they won.
Exactly, because they did.
Yeah.
Because they did. And then you see the referees are conferring at center court, and then they come in and they say, no good, the shot doesn't count, get out of here, go back to Manasquan to Cape Henlopen, which is one of the areas they always talk about when they do the local weather forecast in the Jersey Shore, from Manasquan to Cape Henlopen. Manasquan on the Jersey Shore. And Cape Henlopen's down near Delaware.
Now, let me ask you something.
Yes,
in
Robin.
A situation like this, where it is so, so clear, would they reverse a ruling after the fact?
Well, I think if the association, it's a New Jersey something association, I don't know specifically which title it is, but this is for a championship in this particular region. And so even though the officials blew the call, I think if you're the athletic commission or the association that sanctions this championship, you got to go back and say, this was a bad call. We've got to make sure that the right team won. And there's no doubt the team that scored won the game fair and square. Simple as that. And they should do that. And, they don't do that normally. It's the New Jersey SIAA, says Jay Reed in New Jersey. The New Jersey State, I don't know what IAA means, but it's obviously an interconference athletic association. So it's a high school title. It's a championship game. And the kids from Manasquan got screwed. And again, I don't have any friends in Camden. I have friends in Camden. I have people who own property in Camden, we know. So it's not like I was rooting. You didn't bet on this game. I don't think this game was on the board somewhere in any casino, even offshore. Even like in Atlantic City, they weren't even paying attention to this. So anyway, hopefully they get this straightened out. And these are kids now. These are high school kids. So they never reverse a call after a game is over and decided in major sports. Right. They don't go back and say, they'll say, oh, we made a mistake. Like you see that a lot in NFL games or in an NBA game. The officials will say, yeah, we watched it again and we made a mistake. But that's like one of 82 games in the regular season or one of 17 games in the NFL. It's still wrong, but they're never, for the most part, going to go back and say, you know what, let's replay the last couple of seconds. In high school, this should be different. So again, I'm not going to make a big deal of this. I wanted to address this because I saw that this was a big story. And when you see Dick Vitale and Dan Wetzel and people who cover college and high school basketball, this is one of those stories that's not getting the attention that it deserves. And again, we just want to see things treated properly. This was an absolute total steal of a championship. So that's the latest on high school. Of course, we got a lot of college basketball. It's championship week. A lot of big games today and tonight as we head on. And we'll keep you up to date on stuff going on. Later on, the great Jeff DeForest, Defo as we know him, over there in Miami, he'll be checking in with the show. We'll get an update on what's going on. A lot of Florida teams involved in NCAA basketball championship week action last night. And we'll talk to Defo about that coming up at 4:30. Luigi will join us at 5 o'clock. I mean, he has become such a part of the fabric of the Tony Bruno Sports Network that even though he's not an official full-scale employee, he's part of the family.
Yes, he is.
And I don't mean the Gambino or the Merlino, skinny Joey Merlino crime family.
We decided to put him in just on regular segments.
He's on a retainer.
Yeah.
So people love Luigi. Segment. He's been a part of our family. He started out as a listener, and then he came in and I started answering phone calls, and he moved his way up to the highest levels you can get, unpaid contributor to the Tony Bruno Show. And when you work your way up to an unpaid regular contributor to this network, we will send you an NPR tote bag as a token of our appreciation. All you have to do is contribute $15 a week for the next 3 years, and you too can be an unpaid contributor to the Tony Bruno Sports Network, and we thank you for your cooperation.
And we have some questions already on social media right
yes.
now. John Shelton asking, why was the show taken down from YouTube yesterday?
Probably because of music?
Good question, John.
Was it because of YouTube had an outage yesterday? No, it was Facebook
and
Instagram,
yes.
Right? Not YouTube.
This is a complaint that I have, and I'm trying to resolve it, but we do not take it down. YouTube, Twitch, and all these other locations, they have these stupid archaic rules that even though we have a BMI and ASCAP license
yep.
for the radio station, they
not
say,
the other BMI, the body mass index no. numbers. Those numbers, unfortunately, are still too high, but we're working on that.
But
we can't
do
anything about BMI,
all
the
of
music
these,
company.
All of these video companies, even though we are simulcasting a radio station, they say, oh, you're playing music. You're not allowed to. You need to individually get permission from every single artist, which obviously that's not going to happen. So they sometimes take it down depending on what kind of a...
It's an algorithm. There's not people listening to every show. it's some sort of Al Gore rhythm, and I don't think Al Gore has anything to do with it.
And it's not live. When we're live, it's fine.
Yeah, when you're watching it, it doesn't come down. Yeah. But then after the show airs on YouTube live, you know, they pull it down, and then you have to edit it, or I don't know how they deal with it. But so we're on so many different videos platforms now.
Yes.
So if you're not watching us on YouTube, we're live on.
And you know what?
We're live on Facebook, right? Where else are we live, Robin?
I believe that the very first time today.
Are we on Rumble?
We are on Rumble.
Let's get ready to Rumble. The check's in the mail.
So if
Michael
you are
Buffer.
If you are watching on Rumble, please let us know because
yes.
I would love to see our Rumble fans on there.
We love Rumble. We love all of our video streamers out there. We're still on Twitch, right? We're on Twitch?
I don't think we are on Twitch today.
Are we on X Live, formerly Twitter?
Yes, we are on X Live. We are on Facebook. We are on YouTube and Rumble. The four.
And Rumble.
Four.
How many? Four.
And, of course, we are on the TBSN audio app.
Exactly.
I believe Anthony Mack, who is at the Naughty Parrot, I believe that's in Fort Myers, maybe?
Yes, it is. Does he, like, go there every day for lunch?
I don't.
Or does he work there?
I don't know, but he is listening in. And I think Michael Heilman?
Yes.
Got you guys on Rumble.
This is awesome, baby!
Thank you, Michael, for checking
Thank
in.
Thank you. No, we're not on MySpace. We still don't know where they got the smartest man in social media history.
Tom from
MySpace.
Tom from MySpace.
You want to talk about a guy who did it right. He started MySpace, and then, you know, that right after AOL online and back in the primitive days of social media, MySpace was the shit. Can we say it was the shit?
Yes.
And I mean the good shit, not the bad shit. MySpace was the shit. And then this guy made gazillions of dollars and said, that's enough. Cash me in, boss.
Yep.
I'm out of here.
He sold it.
And we have never heard from him again. Does anybody know where he is?
Do we even know what his last name was?
I don't know.
Tom from MySpace. That's all I know. He was always your first friend on MySpace.
Yes, I'm still a friend. Is MySpace account still active, Robin? Because I know it became a music. I know it became a lot of new artists started putting their stuff on MySpace, you know, and selling records and stuff.
I cannot tell you the last time I have checked out MySpace. Is it even still a thing?
I don't know. Let me log into it right now. Do you know my password? Is that in the book, Robin?
91.
Here it is, MySpace.
It's still a thing?
Well, it says Tony Bruno, MySpace, Venice, California.
Wow.
2,500 followers. How about that?
So, Tony.
Yes.
If it still has if it still has the Venice address, that means that it has been at least 15 years since you have logged into MySpace.
We moved out of Venice in 2011, right? Yes. 2011. How many years ago is that, Robin? Again, I'm not good at math. That's
12.
How many?
12.
12 years ago.
12, yeah.
Now, do you know what
12,
my 13, sign
13
in?
13 years.
13 years ago. Now, I can sign in with Facebook or Twitter. Wow. I have an account. Do you know my MySpace username?
Sure if it's that long ago, it would have been your Yahoo account.
My sports bag? Yeah, well, okay. Let me go in here. Let's see. What would my what would my password have been? I'm going to hit forgot password because who remembers a password, you know, from 13 years ago? So I have to say that I'm not a robot. So let me I apologize. I just want to do this live to prove that we're not faking it. We're just making it. Anyway, so enter your username. We'll email instructions on how to reset your password. Learn more about how to receive. Okay, I'm not a robot. I don't know what the username is. I have the reCAPTCHA, and then I submit. And then the email you entered could. Oh, that's the wrong email. I put Tony Bruno Show. I put the original one in there, but then they asked me to put my email, my password in it.
You're old. Your old email.
I know. That's what I did.
Giuseppe Alberto checking in. Love the show, Tony and Miss Robin.
Thank you so much, Giuseppe.
And once again, I will ask everybody, like, follow, subscribe.
Yes.
What else can you do?
You can send us tips. No, you don't have to.
And share.
Share the show.
Sharing is caring. Please share the show. That is how we get the word out there. Because there's a lot of people who thought Tony was not on the air anymore. And when they're finding, they're like, oh my God, I'm so excited. So, yes, let people know.
The email could not be found. How can that be? What other email would I have had from my MySpace account?
Well, maybe you switched it over to Tony.
I don't think so. Let me check.
Well, you would. This was Tony. Your MySpace time frame was during your man whore phase. What were you, what email addresses?
I didn't
addresses?
Have any different what email man whore email accounts.
Ah, yes, you did. Because I believe you did.
Remember, I joined Twitter in 2009.
Yeah.
So obviously people weren't doing that stuff on Twitter.
No,
when you're whores.
But
there wasn't even a, an OnlyFans,
no,
or all these other Hinge,
back in the good
all
old
these
days.
Other whoring sites. You had to pay for that shit back then. But don't share, because you won't be able to turn back time, and you won't find a way. Thank you, Joe Quills. That was one of the great songs of all time. You know what I mean? No, my account was not Carlos Danger. No, it wasn't What the Fauci. Because Fauci was back then, he was botching the whole AIDS epidemic, and nobody knew about it before he became
He was testing it on kids in foster care.
Exactly right. Anyway, I'll try to get into this later.
By the way, that's not just a thing.
No, that's a fact.
That's a fact.
That's the fact, Jack.
And we can always be reached via our phone number, which is both our voicemail and text line. So call 352-234-8669. That's
what's that number again, Robin?
3-3-3-3-3-5-2-2-3-4-Tony.
And today's a big day in the National Hockey League too, Robin, because it's trade deadline. Already some big trades, and we'll follow those. The Flyers have made trades, and so you expect to see a lot of action on this trade deadline day in the National Hockey League. We'll have NBA talk. We'll preview a lot of the big games coming up tonight in the NCAA tournament, championship week. And we've got all kinds of updates today too, Robin. We will have a parrot fever update.
Yes.
Parrot, not jungle fever, not boogie fever. Remember boogie fever by the Jackson 5?
And not just, what was his name? Fever on
Dr. Johnny Fever.
Dr. Johnny Fever.
Exactly right, on WKRP in Cincinnati, where
Cincinnati.
I think I did overnights there for a couple of years. But
did
there's
you?
A lot of fever.
Wait, what?
No, I'm joking.
Oh. In related news, this is from Area Code 3. This is Tom in Indiana saying, in related news and in the face of indisputable video evidence, Joey Chestnut destroyed three jabronis in a two-minute pierogi eating contest at the Cavaliers game.
Last night, did he really?
Yeah, I guess.
I mean, that guy's just an eating machine.
Yes.
You know,
now, get this. He ate 39.
39 pierogi?
And the other three combined only ate 23.
Wow. I mean, he's a hot dog machine. We know that.
Wow. But this
the
was
guy's
pierogis.
A world champ. I know. So pierogies, because we're in, you know, this is the Lenten season, and a lot of Polish folks eat pierogi. I like some pierogies. I don't like the one with the sauerkraut inside, though. That's nasty. You like it as it smells up the house.
Yeah.
You know, they're tasty, but when you cook sauerkraut or any of that crap in your house, it stinks up the house for days.
It's funny. I go through phases of liking sauerkraut.
I like it on a hot dog.
Yeah.
But not when you're like steaming cabbage or all that other stuff.
I don't like it on regular hot dogs. I like it on Polish sausages.
Well, who doesn't? Meanwhile, we have a sad story coming out of Philadelphia now. This is breaking news. There are reports of at least seven people shot in the northeast Philadelphia area around Cottman and the Boulevard. Again, this is a report coming from Philadelphia. Breaking news from Philly Crime Update, which is a legit crime policing politics site. At least seven people shot, possibly juveniles, in the northeast section of Philadelphia, and that's ongoing. So we'll keep an eye on that. And obviously, if you live in the Philadelphia area, you're probably aware of this, unless the local stations are ignoring it. But, you know, these are the stories that, you know, we see every day, unfortunately, in a lot of cities. I don't know why at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, seven kids are out there shooting each other, and that's what it appears to be. And we've seen a lot of this, but hey, to some people, I guess it doesn't exist. They want to ignore it. But anyway, we'll get back to sports and talk about the other things. But when news of that matter breaks, when you talk about seven people shot, We call that a mass shooting, right? Is it a mass shooting if it's just one person shooting multiple people?
No.
Or if there's seven, you know, say there's seven people and they're having a gunfight.
I think it's a mass shooting depending on how many people got hurt or killed.
I don't know. I don't know, to be honest with you. I don't know how you decipher that or determine what's a mass. To me, when there's more than one person shot.
Yeah, Steve Keeley says that there were seven people shot.
All right, so I'll let Steve Keeley, who's a great reporter in Philadelphia on Fox 29. Philadelphia has a lot of people who ignore these stories. Steve Keeley, and there's a couple of other, and mostly it's independent journalists, former cops, who report these stories, because the mainstream media will get to this later on in the day when they finally start seeing Twitter overflowing, and guys like Steve Keeley, who's probably on the scene, because that's what good reporters do. But a lot of people ignore Steve Keeley and actually condemn him in some media, claiming that he puts these stories out to sensationalize crime. No, he puts the stories out because he's on the scene and there's tape of the crime, videotape, and there's also videotape of the perpetrators. And so the people who just want to ignore this are just living in a fantasy world. That's all. That's all you have to just admit there's a problem. That's all. I mean, to deny it, how do you deny that it's happening?
91 Sixers.
Tom R., what up from San Jose? What up?
He said,
Original Joes.
Four people or more injured or killed is considered a mass shooting. And sadly,
they were not on the Boulevard subway, because Jay from Boulevard subway says that they're going to get the Boulevard subway built by 2039. As long as SEPTA gets $10 billion to build it. And by the way, nobody wants it, but he says so. So I guess what he says goes. But anyway, let's get it back to what's going on.
Now, yesterday, if you were watching, we did a story on the Guinness World Record holders of the longest
tongue
and the largest girth tongue that just won.
Because this is a science show.
It is a science
show. And when somebody breaks a record, like Joey Chestnut today.
Yeah, we measured ourselves, and afterwards we did, tape don't lie, that's correct.
Ball don't lie either.
We had several people that then texted in their length and their girth. And I think that this is
We're just talking tongues now.
Yes, but this was probably more information that I wanted to know from our fans. This was probably not a good idea to ask people to do that. Oh, Tony, gosh, time is just flying past.
I know.
Today.
We got a jam-packed show today, too.
Yes, we do.
I mentioned we'll have the latest trend for women. And since Robin is a woman, and I can assure you,
last time I checked,
she has been confirmed. I have scientific evidence that Robin is, in fact, a woman in this day and age when people have a hard time determining what a woman is. And I know I'm a man, but I'm way past 40. So anyway, we'll get to the latest trend for women. We'll have a parrot fever outbreak. We'll have we'll check in to see what our good old friend Alyssa Milano is up to lately. And we'll have a On This Date in History video. I can't believe it's been that long, Robin. It was 43 years ago today. You know what happened 43 years ago today? Let's see, how old would I have been in 1981? Well, actually, my second son would have been born, Chris, and then Deanna was born in 82. So I had two kids by 1981, one in 77.
I was in elementary school.
And then my second son, Chris, was born in 81, and my daughter, Deanna, was born in 82. So I know I was 30 years old at the time, 30 years old in 1982. So I'd been 29 in 1981. But we will tell you what happened on this date. March 6, 1981, and we have all kinds of NHL updates. We'll have a Greg Olsen update. It's a jam-packed show, so stick around. We're just getting started. We have text burning up the phone lines. You can participate in the show wherever you are. It's Tony Bruno, Miss Robin. It's What Up Wednesday on the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Bud Light presents Real Men of Genius. Real men of genius.
Today we salute you, Mr. Used Car Lot Auto Salesman.
Mr. Used Car Lot Auto Salesman.
Slick back hair, a sharkskin suit, alligator boots. You cultivate a look that oozes, trust me.
I think that I can trust you.
You stand behind every car you sell. Because if you stood in front and the brakes failed, you'd be crushed.
You better watch out now.
Oil leak? What oil leak? That puddle under the car is just sweat from all that horsepower.
Let the horses out now.
So crack open an ice-cold Bud Light, Mr. Peddler of the Sheet Metal. Because when life hands you lemons, you sell them.
Mr. Used Car Lot Auto Salesman.
Bud Light Beer, Anheuser-Busch, St. Louis, Missouri. Bud Light presents Real Men of Genius.
Real Men of Genius.
Today we salute you, Mr. Next Day Carpet Installer.
Mr. Next Day Carpet Installer.
Because when we're jonesing for carpet, we're jonesing for it right now.
Totally jonesing.
Thanks to you, we have absolutely no problem buying carpet over the phone, sight unseen.
Just pick up the phone.
A near miracle. An entire basement of wall-to-wall shag in less time than it takes to order a pizza.
I like pepperoni.
Your motto, if you're a payin', I'm a layin'.
Oh, yeah!
So crack open an ice-cold Bud Light, king of the carpet men. You not only go the distance for us, you do it wearing knee pads.
Mr. Next Day Carpet Installer.
Bud Light Beer, Anheuser-Busch, St. Louis, Missouri.
Oh, you need Bud Light. You enjoy, joy, joy, your fluffin' peanut butter. You're glad you have enough for another fluffer nutter.
Now back to the biggest sports network on the planet, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Waterloo again, Robin?
Sorry.
Didn't we play Waterloo yesterday?
Maybe we did, but I was just rushing back from the bathroom.
Okay.
I barely made
That's all right. It's all right. It's a decent song. Of course, I never saw Mamma Mia, and I love ABBA, and they tried a comeback, but that didn't work, did it? Did the comeback of ABBA work, Robin?
Maybe not so much here, but worldwide.
Didn't they release a new album? They got back together, and then everybody went out and bought their new album. And then 2 weeks later, nobody cared anymore. Listen,
true.
I loved ABBA back in the 80s. But remember, if it wasn't for Mamma Mia, Mamma Mia basically reignited the ABBA craze. Because remember, they're back, what, 80s? How
Some
old were you when ABBA?
True fans never have always been crazy about ABBA.
No, I loved ABBA too back in the days.
I never stopped
Who doesn't love hot blondes? Two hot chicks with one dorky dude. Swedish chicks, you know, ever since the Swedish bikini team was pimping beer in the United States of America.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, by the way, I don't think they were really Swedish. But if they weren't, they were good representations of hot Swedish blondes. You know what I'm saying, Robin?
Absolutely.
Meanwhile, let's get it back to the program.
Okay.
Yes, Tony, the ABBA song...
Gimme
is a banger at the bars right now, is it really? That's Tom from the 203. That's the great Trevor from the 203, not the 305. Play Gimme a Man tonight. What song is that?
Gimme a Man After Midnight.
Is that another ABBA song?
That's
but that wasn't one of the hits. That was one of the fringe oldies. We only play the hits here, Robin. We're not playing B-sides.
Gimme is a big song. You just don't know.
No, Luigi's coming up at 5 o'clock. Luigi's out there working, you know, scouring the Delaware Valley, looking for late-breaking news. Hopefully, you know, he used to live right up there in the Northeast where this shooting is occurring this afternoon. And so he's not in the Northeast anymore. He's in South Philly. You know what I'm saying?
Yep, yep, yep.
That's a banger right now at the bars?
I didn't know.
It is playing at the Sansom Street Gym locker room right now, and I can guarantee you there's always a steady flow of ABBA and, of course, the greatest gay representation group of all time. Well, not Queen, because nobody watched Queen because they knew Freddie Mercury was gay. A lot of people didn't know in the beginning, and they didn't care. Nobody cared that Freddie Mercury. Barry Manilow. Nobody cared. Nobody knew or cared. They suspected. I'm talking about YMCA guys.
The Village People.
The Village People. I think the Village People were probably the most successful gay group of all time because they didn't hide it, and nobody cared. You don't think the Village People, when they were performing all their great songs, that everybody, regardless of your sexual preference, was doing YMCA and in the Navy? You think they cared that the Village People were gay guys?
I think it's so funny because I do not ever recall their sexuality ever being mentioned. Ever.
No, but people sort of knew, right? Did they not?
Yeah,
suspected.
You would think.
I mean, if you're doing in the Navy, and you just read the words of YMCA.
I know.
We're all doing this in the club. YMCA. You can get a good meal. Just can you play it so we can break down the lyrics, Robin, in case you missed it? Wham didn't hide it either. Well, Wham, I mean, they weren't both gay, were they? Andrew Ridgely wasn't gay, was he?
No.
I don't know.
And you saw
the documentary on Wham, and obviously, you know, to me, you talk about one of the greatest singing voices of all time.
Yeah.
And remember when he wrote Choose Life? Mm-hmm. Imagine if he were alive today, how much hate we'd be getting for wearing a Choose Life shirt. And you know what we're talking about, right?
Yes. So the lyrics, young man, there's no need
I need to play the song,
Robin. Oh, you want me to
play it? Yeah, I want to be able to do the YMCA thing. You know what I mean?
Okay, hold on.
I mean, I haven't done that in a while, and I haven't really done any cardio today. And this is a show about health and fitness. We'll have health updates today also, and we'll have a trend update because it's all about trends. And also pop culture because this is a big pop culture show, Robin.
Now, this is just those people that were asking why the show disappears off of YouTube, et cetera.
Because of this.
It's because of this. Right?
I don't care. This is research. And screw you, YouTube, and the people who run it. But
we should be able to play all this. And not only that, but we're playing it off of your website.
YouTube is a music channel. You can get anything. You can have a good meal. You can hang with the boys. You could do whatever you feel. So crank it up, Robin.
Okay.
This is one of the most iconic. I know Donald Trump uses it, and I don't know if he's gay or not. But this is a song that everybody loves. When this song comes on, Robin, no matter where you are, dance floor, wedding, sweet 16, gay or straight or bi, everybody gets on the dance floor. And you know what they start singing, Robin? Young man. Crack it up, Rock. There's no need to feel down.
Young man.
Get yourself off the ground.
Now tell me where to stop it if you need to zone in.
Two. There's no need to be unhappy. See? Young man, when you're short on your dough. Everybody now, come on, Robin.
I'm sure you'll
get up there. Let's do it.
Yeah.
It's fun to stay at the YMCA.
Hey, what was
here
that?
It is. Everything to enjoy. You can bang out with all. Not bang out. You can hang out with all the boys. You can bang out with all the boys too. Whatever you want to do. YMCA. You can get yourself clean. You can have a good time.
Meal.
You can meal, and you can do whatever you feel. You feeling me?
Are you listening
to me? I said, young man, who do you want to be? I said, young man, you can make your real dreams. You can get to know this one thing. You got to know this one thing. Yes.
No, they don't.
No man does it all by themselves. Put your pride on the shelf. To the YMCA, I'm sure they could help you today, tonight, and tomorrow. It's fun to stay at the YMCA. I wonder if our good buddy Angel Martinez, who's having a wedding coming up on June 15th, whether this will be banging through. This banger will be hitting at the wedding ceremony and the after party.
No, not only will he be having a wedding, but you will be doing something special that day as well.
I will be doing the YMCA as I preside as the ordained minister who will be giving the vows. Will I be giving the vows?
Receiving the vows.
No, I'm not receiving them. They're receiving them.
No, they're giving them. You're receiving
them. I'm a receiver?
Yes, you're the receiver.
So I'm the quarterback?
You're the quarterback.
And I tell Angel to go deep, and then I tell his lovely fiance to just stay there and block in case somebody rushes the minister. This was not Chan Ho Park's walk-up song. Come on.
You know, I have Angel and Debbie truly thought this through about you officiating?
We have the invitation. It just came in the mail. Well, where is it, Robin?
We're not showing it to anybody.
No, we're not showing it, but...
But yeah, it's... I don't know if he's truly... Like, has he truly thought this through?
Yeah, of course he did. They've been together a long time, just like
I
are.
I'm not talking about them getting married. About you officiating is what I'm talking
Why not?
About.
I've been an ordained minister for years.
I know.
I'm a holy man.
You're
so send me a dollar. I'll pass around the, you know, I'm not charging them for this, of course, Robin, because, you know, they're friends. They're good friends. They're family. But I will be plastic. I got to get one of those baskets, the wicker baskets, because I don't want to pass around a metal tray.
Uh-huh.
I want to pass around a wicker basket. I got to get one like they used to have in church when I was a kid.
Wait,
you know, the one with the long handle?
Where are you passing this around?
At the wedding.
For who?
For the minister.
Oh,
when you go to a church, right? Say you go to a Catholic church or you have a rabbi presiding, don't you give the minister an envelope and he puts it in his pocket at a wedding, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Right?
So you're just going to take tips from the audience? Nice.
No. Wait, bring that down again.
Oh, hold on. Yeah.
Tony, does Tony crank YMCA on the boat while trolling through the no-wake zones in Florida?
Seriously.
By the way, all you strappers who just buy a boat and don't know anything about boats, those markers that say no wake, that doesn't mean you're going to a funeral. It means slow down and don't make waves because then you'll wash other boats onto the shore. Luckily, that's why people have lifts here in Florida. So when some strapper goes running right by your lot and your canal, you know, your boat doesn't get turned over. I'm doing my Creflo Dollar impression now. You know who Creflo Dollar is, Robin?
No.
That's bad minister knowledge. Two village people stole my catalytic converter. Come on, man. That's right. I mailed in my 1999 to the Church of Universal Christ in Modesto, California.
Tony got the upgraded.
That's right. You
version.
Think I'm going to take just the bargain basement, you know, standard issue.
Hell
I've
no.
got the license plate. I've got the card. I got the thing you put on the windshield so you can go to and park illegally.
Yep.
And even park in a bike lane so all the strappers in Philly can go nuts, all of these urban people who want everything to be buildings and no cars. Bike lanes everywhere. Screw cars. Take SEPTA, even though you might get shot on it, but take it anyway. Because these people know better, these hipsters who move into cities and determine that they're the ones who are going to decide what the future is for everybody else. Anyway, we'll get to the all the other good stuff. There's a Greg Olson update, and it's not even an update. It's old news. And this is how crazy we've become in this country, Robin. Now, you know Greg Olson. Greg Olson was a great tight end.
Mm-hmm.
And you know where he played college football? At the U. The U. You know what the U is, Robin? The University of Miami, the Hurricanes.
Hurricanes.
Yeah, you know who's a huge U fan?
Who?
Not U2 and not YouTube.
Who, you?
No, the great Pete Shepherd.
Yes, he is.
Pete Shepherd's got hurricane stuff coming out the yin-yang.
He's got hurricane fever.
Exactly right. And he went to the University of Miami. He also was a great tight end in the NFL, Carolina Panthers, and then everybody knew he was going to go into the booth and be a broadcaster. And he was the guy who replaced Joe Buck, on the number one team. Actually, he replaced Troy Aikman because Joe Buck and Troy Aikman went from Fox to ESPN to do Monday Night Football for the last couple of years. And then a guy that I've loved for many, many times, who's now his number one guy at Fox, had Greg Olson as a partner. But once they signed Tom Brady to a massive contract, Greg Olson was, you know, he'll be still at Fox, I guess, and they'll put him on one of the other teams, but not the number one team. And I think Greg Olson understands it. But I see Greg Olson trending today on social media, and I'm like, what happened now? What happened with Greg Olson? So Greg Olson, who's a husband, dad, former player, advocate, coach, and a good guy. Anybody who's met Greg Olson, I mean, it's impossible to not like the guy. He's a great guy. But now all of a sudden, people are dredging up something that happened when he was in college. And we're talking about 2005.
Wow.
And the University of Miami, anybody who knows, the, you know, they had their own way.
Yeah,
and
known
if anybody
as a party
knows,
school.
Yeah, it's still a party school, but not like they rolled back in the day with the seventh floor crew. Now, I don't know if you've seen, and I saw this back in the day. It was funny, right? Mm-hmm. It was funny. No, we're not going to play Rock You Like a Hurricane. We did that yesterday. Not You Porn. We're not on there yet. Yes, I mentioned the shooting at Cotman and Rising Sun. Now they're saying eight people are shot. So Greg Olson is trending, not because of his work in the community, not because he was a great tight end, but because of what happened in 2005, Robin. And you know what happened in 2005, Robin?
What happened?
The Seventh Floor Crew. Do you remember what was the song by the Seventh Floor Crew? We're going to play it right now. And I don't think they'll pull this off. I don't think they'll pull, that YouTube will bring this down. Because this is an actual, anyway, I'll play it as soon as I can find it here. The Seventh Floor Crew
is apologizing for a profane, sexually explicit rap song made by several football players.
The Seventh Floor Crew.
That's not what they said. They said something else.
What's your name? G-Reg. What you do? Get head. How you drop my drawers and let us see my third leg. Chilling on the seventh floor. I gotta let these chickens know. Big Greg is in the house and I finna make these hoes choke. On my balls, on my dick, then I'm busting up quick. On a face, on a chest.
Sing a crack.
Between the breasts. Come on, fellas, let's get weird. Stick your dick up in the ear. While I'm laughing at these guys, a second to all in the eyes.
Big number 82 at the U with the Seventh Floor Crew, Robin. How great is that song? I mean, that's why he's accepted by all University of Miami.
Alone.
Not the fourth floor stall. No, that's a different guy. He's a big fan of the show, too. He needs to get the fan installed up in that fourth floor stall, though. You can't have a bathroom in a big building without a fan in there.
Unless,
am I wrong?
Unless somebody has raped, murdered, violently assaulted somebody while they were in college. Can we just, like, let everything else kind of go?
I don't think they're trying to cancel him. It was just brought up. And I thought, what's going on? I thought
so
Greg
ridiculous.
Olson got another job. And he's been going out to conferences. And he's a guy who, obviously, if Greg Olson can go from this guy to the Fox lead analyst on Sundays, anything is possible for all of us. And that's the Seventh Floor Crew. And I guarantee you, anybody who hadn't heard that song, heard it now, would not even realize. That's Big 82. Come on, man. Let me play it one more time, Robin. It's a great song. Listen. Again, this was Michael Wilbon on Pardon the Interruption on ESPN back in 2005 again. Now, let me bring this up. I'm going to play this on the air, Robin. Is my video thing set to go?
Yep.
Because I want you to see it and watch.
I want to see it all big.
Make it big, Greg. Well, he says that. That's what they did at the U, you know, back in the day. And I'm not even talking back in the Michael Irvin days. I'm talking about 2005, yo, when the Seventh Floor Crew was rolling in the 305.
University of Miami is apologizing for a profane, sexually explicit rap song made by several football players.
The Seventh Floor Crew.
That she was getting fucked on the seventh floor.
Yeah. Yeah, come on, Greg.
What was your name?
G-Reg.
What you do?
Get hit.
How you
drop my drawers and let us see my third leg.
That third leg.
On the seventh floor, I gotta let these chickens know. Big Greg is in the house and I finna make these hoes choke. I'm a balls on my dick, then I'm busting up quick. On a face, on a chest, stick my dick between the breasts. Come on, fellas,
let's wow.
Stick your dick up in the ear. While I'm laughing at these guys, a second up all in the eyes.
I think they got it all. They pretty much covered it all in
now
that,
you can't,
they?
You just can't write rhyme like that anymore. Forget the two live crew. Forget the cutting crew. Remember the cutting crew, Robin?
I do not.
They had that big hit song. I've seen it. I know. I've been in love before. Look up the cutting crew, Robin. The cutting crew. Wasn't that their hit song?
I've been in love before. I just died in your arms.
Yeah, they had a bunch of hits. Yeah. I died in your arms last night, and now I'm being arrested for murder and suspicion of murder. But the cutting crew, was the cutting crew better? Patty Perks, that was good writing there. Absolutely. Those University of Miami kids, they're student athletes when they're not rolling.
Oh, here it is.
Yeah.
I remember this song.
Yeah, this was slow jam for white, you know, white trash dudes from England, I think. Weren't they from England?
I'm sure.
And now people are requesting ZZ Top's
okay,
Pearl
we're
necklace.
Not gonna do, we're,
no, we're not going to do a block of profane music.
This is already going to require, you know.
That's all right, Robin.
This,
don't worry about
these
it.
These videos clearly are not going to be available immediately after the show. They're going to be gone. I think
people are finding out about the seventh floor clue right now, crew. Because what, 2005? How many years ago is that? 15, 25?
So it's somebody who hates
so
math.
It's 18 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
That's when he, I think 2005 is 18 because it would be 2015, 2025, remove one.
Mm-hmm.
So that's 19 years ago.
Yes.
19 years ago, he was in college and they were getting loose on the seventh floor. This is still playing at the abandoned Clover store in Northeast Philadelphia. You're absolutely right about that.
Hey, Tony,
yes.
I'm just thinking of something since I'm looking up at the big screen here.
What are you thinking of, Robin?
Yesterday, you had an epic rant, and I just wanted to let everybody know that in case you have another one, I am now prepared.
You have it, Bruno? Because I don't plan rants.
No.
I don't script rants. I mean, this is my show sheet. This is what I do. I have little ideas. There's no script involved here. That whole rant yesterday was not, it was organic.
Yes, it was.
And that's the way we like it, Robin.
Yes.
We like everything organic.
So when you have I have to get rid of the banner.
Get rid of the banner?
Oh, yeah. Hold on.
Why? Aren't we doing it live?
But
yeah, you got to go. I'm not ranting right now.
Yeah, so we're not ranting. But that
I mean, there's some shows that they have to have rants every day. So that people
no,
will
they're not
for
scripted.
Clickbait.
But I'm now prepared for you to have.
I don't
a
have
rant.
A rant. I don't have a rant.
You know
today.
What I have to do?
I'm not planning one anyway. You never know what could happen.
Put that up there.
Yes. So I have to be really, really, really outraged to have a rant.
Yes.
And I've been learned to be, you know, you can't be outraged every hour of every day, you know, unless you're doing political talk. You know, where two sides are screaming about things and they're going crazy.
It's exhausting. It's exhausting
it is.
For you, and it's exhausting for me.
Exactly.
If you are outraged all the time.
It is. You can't be outraged all the time.
No, you got to admit.
That's why you go into the Tony Bruno, what was that called? What is it called now, Robin?
Energy saver mode.
Energy saver mode. You know, like your computer. Does the computer still go into energy saver?
But if you were to have.
Do I go into DOS mode? Remember that? When the screen would get back, and there'd be like a couple of things up in the corner that
would
flash.
Just be the little green.
Yeah,
thing
the little green dots.
No, if you were to have a rant every day, then it wouldn't make it special.
No, you can't plan rant. You can plan rants,
but then they're not special.
Exactly right.
And Matt Raposa says, and it's not good for your blood pressure.
Exactly right. I'm hooked up to a blood pressure machine 24/7. Where's my little? Pulse ox thing that I used to have here. I had one of those little pulse ox meters, Robin.
It's probably next to your.
No, I got it right here.
Oh.
See, look, this show, we're prepared for any particular emergency. You know, if I go into, I won't go into anaphylactic shock because I'm not allergic to stuff. But here it is. Let me turn it on just to show you, the Tony Bruno Show listener, where my pulse and oxygen levels are right now. You don't get this on most shows because most people are afraid to reveal their personal information. Let's see. So 95, the 95, not John Fetterman's 95. So right now I'm at 95%, and then what's my pulse rate? I can't stop moving.
It's 71.
Is that good?
Yeah.
96,
oh,
see?
Now it's 82.
82, 96, 84, 34, hot, 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 95. 97, see? Oxygen is good. You want to be in that 95 to 100.
You want to be at least over 92.
Exactly right.
Anything under 92 is not good.
Exactly right. Anything under 92?
Yeah, and 92 or less is not a good thing.
Then I would be catatonic, and I'd be doing like public radio.
Anything under 92 just means that you're not getting good oxygen.
This is fresh air, and I hope that you're driving home.
Jason Padua, we are not measuring tongues today.
No. We're measuring vitals. It's all about the vitals, Robin, not the vittles. That's what you have when you live in the South and you're hungry as shit.
Yes.
Right, the vittles. Did you ever refer to food as vittles, Robin?
No, I did not.
Come on. What's the matter with you, Robin? I'm going to get on a horse with no name, Robin?
Yes.
I know you're a big horsey girl. That's not Herman Cain's 999 plan. No, it's not. Great. Herman Cain, 99, the late Herman Cain. Remember he had 999? That was his plan.
Oh.
I forget what it was about, but it sounded cool. Yeah, you got to stay healthy and hydrated. Speaking of which, where's my damn water at,
I don't know, why don't you get it while we're in commercial break?
It's only a quick break, Robin. I don't even have to pee yet. That means I am not drinking enough water. So drink enough water. The sun's coming out. It's becoming spring. This weekend, we turn the clocks. Then we go spring forward, right?
Correct.
So we spring forward, and we get more light. Let there be light. The Reverend Tony has spoken. Am I a reverend, or what would you call me? Minister Tony? Father Tony? Brother Tony?
Padre.
Padre Pio, Padre Antonio. You can call me whatever you want, but just call me. 352-234-8669. How about that? I'm learning, folks. All you got to do is repeat after me. 352-234-8669. That's the number. Not for the plumber. That's the number to text and be in touch so you're in touch, as they used to say on 2020 with Barbara Walters and Hugh Downs. We're coming right back. Stick around. You can't remember your name, 'cause there ain't no one for to give you no pain.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Do you have feelings of inadequacy? Do you suffer from shyness? Do you sometimes wish you were more assertive? If you answered yes to any of these questions, ask your doctor or pharmacist about tequila.
Tequila.
Tequila is the safe, natural way to feel better and more confident about yourself and your actions. Tequila can help ease you out of your shyness and let you tell the world that you're ready and willing to do just about anything. You'll notice the benefits of tequila almost immediately, and with a regimen of regular doses, you can overcome any obstacles that prevent you from living the life you want to live. Shyness and awkwardness will be a thing of the past, and you'll discover many talents you never knew you had. Stop hiding and start living with tequila. Tequila may not be right for everyone. Women who are pregnant or nursing should not use tequila. However, women who wouldn't mind nursing or becoming pregnant are encouraged to try it. Side effects may include dizziness, nausea, vomiting, incarceration, erotic lustfulness, loss of motor control, loss of clothing, loss of money, loss of virginity, delusions of grandeur, table dancing, headache, dehydration, dry mouth, and a desire to sing karaoke and play all night rounds of strip poker, truth or dare, and naked twister. Warning, the consumption of alcohol may make you think you're whispering when you're not, is a major factor in dancing like a retard, may cause you to tell your friends over and over again that you're in love with them, also may cause you to think you can sing. Alcohol may lead you to believe that ex-lovers are really dying for you to telephone them at 4 a.m. Alcohol may make you think you can logically converse with members of the opposite sex without spitting. It may create the illusion that you are tougher, smarter, faster, and better looking than most people, and it may lead you to think people are laughing with you. Alcohol may cause pregnancy, and it also may be a major factor in getting your ass kicked. So what are you waiting for? Stop hiding and start living with tequila.
Tequila!
Ladies and gentlemen, you've been waiting, and now it's here. TBSN, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Make some noise!
The Tony Bruno Sports Network. Download the app, tell your friends, the game is on. TBSN.
Deep inside of me, girl, you just don't realize what you do to me. When you hold me in your arms so tight, you let me know everything's alright.
I'm hooked on a feeling.
See, now there's a big debate about this song, Robin. This is not the original version, as you know, right? I'm correct.
Okay, I'm sure you are. I'm not going to question your musical knowledge.
Now, who did this version, Robin?
This is Blue Swede.
Blue Swede. That's not that new stuff that Nick Cale's selling in the morning. That's Blue Chew or something,
Blue
right?
Blue Chew.
Blue Chew is like a male enhancement product.
Is it?
Is it for and girls?
You'll
and
love
and
it
she'll love it too, apparently. Blue Swede back in the day. But the original version was done by you know who, Robin?
I do not.
I can't believe you don't know this. I think it was Tommy James and the Shondells, wasn't it?
Why did I not know that? Wow.
Because it's the greatest song ever written. Did they do Hooked on a Feeling?
Hooked on a Feeling. It is a great song.
I may be wrong about Tommy James and the Shondells. Who did the original Hooked on a Feeling? That was, what's his name? We play him in one of the commercials. Hooked on a Feeling was the guy, the original one, not Mark James, B.J. Thomas. He's in the old Coca-Cola commercial that we play. Here's B.J. Thomas for Coca-Cola. The original version was by B.J. Thomas.
Did you know that David Hasselhoff recorded that as
Everybody recorded that song. Mark so, James,
BJ,
Emily McIntyre.
I'm going to play the B.J. Thomas.
The B.J. Thomas is the original.
Okay,
now I'll give Blue Swede credit because they cranked it up a little bit. The B.J. Thomas version was much smoother.
Let me hear.
You know what
let
I'm saying?
Let me hear.
Yeah, this is the classic version, Robin. It's not as good of a dance song as the Blue Swede one is. And he was so smooth, B.J. Thomas. And he sang it originally, folks.
I can't stop this feeling deep inside of me. Girl, you just don't realize.
See what I mean? It wasn't as funky and powerful.
When you hold me in your arms tonight, you let me know
everything's all right.
I'm hooked on a feeling.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. There we go.
It's a great song. And the Blue Swede version's all right. Whatever happened to Blue Swede? Did they get...
You know, I don't know, Tony.
Well, if you're going to start playing these songs, Robin, you got to understand. I even messed up. I said it was Tommy James and the Shondell who did Moni Moni.
I am playing songs that you like, and
I love these songs.
But
remember,
well?
Tommy James and the Shondell's Moni Moni was the original, and then that was remade, too. To the one where people curse in clubs. Billy Idol, I think, did it, didn't he?
I do not know. But you know who might know? Jim from Cheltenham, the original archivist, the official archivist of the Tony Bruno Show.
Exactly.
Is on the line right now.
Does he have some fresh tape of old tape to play us today? Jim, good afternoon. How you doing, buddy?
Pretty good, Tony. Pretty good. Remember this Saturday night, you change your clocks again.
That's right. We're going to get more sunlight, baby. More sunlight. By the way, did you see this breaking news? You know, we were talking the other day.
Well,
before we get
scary
to it,
for me because I only live 10 minutes away. So
no, not the one on the boulevard. Not that situation going
well,
on.
Well, it's
in
not the boulevard. You got it's
Rising
Cotman
Sun.
And
that's
Rising
right.
Sun.
Cotman and Rising Sun. Correct.
That's
I said
the
Cotman
area where nothing happens. I mean, this is pretty shocking for this area.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's what is
it?
Eight
where
people shot.
Where 5 points is.
Yeah, I know where 5 points is. Absolutely, I used to live up there when I first got married. Yeah, it's sad. I mean, you know,
they got
Gene
Hospital just down the street.
Yeah. Exactly. Oh, anyway, we'll let the people deal with that. But the Commanders in Washington, guess who they signed today under their new offensive coordinator, Cliff Kingsbury?
Wow.
Zach Ertz is going to play for Washington, reunited with Cliff Kingsbury, of course, who had him in Arizona. So now he's going into his 13th season, a contract worth up to $5 million. He played 3 years in Arizona, obviously was a legend in Philly, you know, as part of the Super Bowl team. And so Zach Ertz, people were thinking, you know, last year when he asked for his release from Arizona, that he may come to the Eagles or he may go to, the Niners or some of these other teams. And then he just waited till the offseason. And now he was signed to the Detroit Lions practice squad the week before the NFC Championship game, but he wasn't elevated to the active roster. So he was picked up, but he was never used in the playoffs in this past season. So that's the latest from the NFL wire so far this afternoon. I'm sorry, Jim, I wanted to get that in.
Okay. Well, on Sunday you'll have the 96th Oscars coming up.
That's right, the 96th Oscars. And I know what the Academy did. I heard Pete Shepard talking about earlier today with one of his great guests who's on all the time. And you know Bill Spiros, who's up there in Boston. He's a great, great guy. He breaks everything down. That they were upset that Barbie and the two top box office movies got nominations for Best Picture because, as you know, Jim, over the years, they never paid attention to the top box office movies.
Well,
they would always give it to some art film or some film nobody watched. So they're trying to get more eyeballs on the Oscars.
Well, that's why they made the change, going from 5 movies to now 10 movies.
Exactly, exactly. Now, do you have any locks? Are you going to release Oscar? You know who we got to get on Friday, Robin? A man who started the whole thing about actually making it legal to bet on the Oscars. Actually, it wasn't legal at the time, but now you can actually bet on the Oscars. And the great John Avello from DraftKings is the first guy that used to call in every year before the Oscars and give his projected odds, even though you couldn't bet on it. And you remember, you couldn't bet on it back day because it was something that was already predetermined because people knew the winners because they were put in an envelope.
Right.
And so then you would think that the people in an envelope would know the winners and then could bet on it.
Yeah, what was the company's name that...
A Waterhouse, something, TD Waterhouse or something.
Something like that.
Yeah. I think they stored it in a jar on Funkin' Wagnall's porch.
But you know what?
No, you know where that's from, Jim? Let's check Jim's note.
Okay. Well, Tony, remember when you were working with Gary, the day after the Academy Awards, both of you guys broke down the Academy Awards.
Well, we broke down everything with Gary Radnich on KNBR 680.
Well, this was a show that we have taped from 2005.
Let's go back to 2005. That's, of course, the same year that Greg Olson was rolling with the 7th floor crew at the University of Miami. I was matriculating Oscar breakdowns with Gary Radnich in San Francisco on KNBR 680, the sports leader. Let's go to the tape, Jim.
This is how it sounded in 2005.
Let's check it out.
Did you check after the program? They had the ABC in Los Angeles people hosting a post game with the great Roger Ebert.
No, I went right. I just watched. I left it on because I was working on my computer. Barbara Walters was on. I wanted to see Will Ferrell, and I left that on. I don't care what dresses they. I don't want to see any of those shows. I will not watch my good friend Pat O'Brien tonight with a microphone asking what kind of dress these people. Who cares? They look nice. Some of them look nice. Some of them look hideous. I don't care who made their dresses. I don't care who made their tuxedos. But one thing you notice, Gary, the bow tie is out. I kept hearing the bow tie is in. And the Dahani Jones, the great linebacker for the Philadelphia Eagles, keeps thinking. I even saw Louis Farrakhan, the great minister Louis Farrakhan, wearing a regular tie over the weekend, flipping around. So even he's abandoned the bow tie. So the bow tie ain't back. Put that in your Tucker Carlson and smoke.
Oh, very good. Now, is it Farrakhan or Farrakhan?
I think it's Farrakhan. I'm not sure, guy. You call him Farrakhan, I'll call him Farrakhan.
I'll tell you, I'm thinking now off the top of my head, the one person who I don't know what she's pulling on, Renee Zellweger. Did you see her?
Yeah,
she could barely walk.
With the dark hair. And,
yeah.
I don't think she's going to age well. I mean, it's not my style. I mean, I know they all get work out here. Everyone gets work except me.
Yeah.
But I don't see Renee Zellweger as one like in her. You know when they do, they had that Fox show last week, Makeup, Stars Without Makeup?
Yes.
I don't think that in about 20 years you're going to see Renee Zellweger on a beach looking really good.
Can we quickly go to Rob? so your basic, your feelings are go for a younger woman rather than Renee Zellweger.
Exactly right.
Oh,
you always go for the younger woman. I know a lot of my older friends out there don't like that, but, you know, hey, and I like older women, but
yes.
When you got the opportunity, you go for the younger woman.
Rom in Union City is on KFB. On those lovely, heartfelt sentiments, it's sure to generate some good, positive emails.
There you go, Tony.
Oh, wow, those were just fun days. Yeah, we had so much fun. And you know what I'm doing, Jim? I'm still trying to have fun. I'm the same guy I was in 2005, in 2000, in 1995, in 1990, in 1985, 80, 75, 70, when I started. I'm the same guy.
People don't realize that was one of the first podcasts, because that was they used to play it on their website. You could listen to any part of the day. You could listen to it.
Yeah, because people who couldn't listen to it live, we were on from – first it started like from 7 to 7:15, and then it went a half an hour. And then there were days I'd do a whole hour. We would just go on and on and on and on and on. And so that was a great and fun segment, and people in the Bay Area to this day, you know, thought that was one of their favorite things in the morning when they're driving to work, to hear a couple of guys on a sports show talk about sports, but then talk about other things like the Academy Awards. Everybody will be talking about it, even if you don't watch it.
You know, it's interesting because even though Philadelphia is your hometown and you then moved to L.A., you always said that your second home was the Bay Area.
Absolutely. Even though I lived in L.A., I was in San Francisco. I don't even know how many times. It had to be over 100 times I've been to San Francisco, if not more.
Way more than that.
Way more than that. I love San Francisco. That's why, you know, I subscribe to the San Francisco Chronicle, because I like to keep track of what's going on there. Because Robin has her mom there. We have relatives there. We have tons of friends.
And now our LFG show, half of the...
Yeah, we have people working for us from out there. So I love this country, and I love San Francisco, and I love L.A. when I live there. I love Philadelphia. When I see stories that are sad, like this shooting going on today, that makes me sad. You know, I can't fix it. But the politicians don't fix it either. They don't even talk about this. They're worried about some car incident 2 weeks ago, and that's what they talk about 24/7 in city council, you know, instead of the stuff that's going on right now that they're not even thinking about addressing. And I don't know how to fix it. I don't have the answers. That's why I'm not a politician.
That show was great, because even when you were between jobs, you kept on doing that show.
Exactly right. It was the longest continuous running operation, I think, since One Life to Live. I think it ran longer than One Life to Live. And the original Dating Game with Jim Lang. I mean, that was it's one of those all-timers. Like 60 Minutes. It's been on as long as 60 Minutes. Except we had fun every day. 60 Minutes is now all of a sudden going off the deep end. But that's their decision. Yeah. It's CBS News. Speaking of CBS, you know what happened on this date? Back in the day, Jim?
What? On this
date? It's a great historic day. On this date, in 1981... March 6, 1981, Walter Cronkite signed off the air on the CBS Evening News, and we have tape. Speaking of tape, let's go to this tape. I'm sure you remember it well, 1981, March 6th, Walter Cronkite. Back in the day, we only had like three channels. You know, you had the CBS, the ABC, and that was before Fox came around. So you had NBC, CBS, and... ABC.
ABC. Yeah.
And you watch the evening news at 6:30, the national. You'd watch the local news between 6 and 6:30. And then Walter Cronkite, one of the legends, this is what happened on this day in 1981, 43 years ago today. Let's all remember, with the archivist, Jim from Cheltenham.
My last broadcast as the anchorman of the CBS Evening News. For me, it's a moment for which I long have planned, but which nevertheless comes with some sadness. For almost two decades, after all, we've been meeting like this in the evenings, and I'll miss that. But those who have made anything of this departure, I'm afraid, have made too much. This is but a transition, a passing of the baton. a great broadcaster and gentleman, Doug Edwards, preceded me in this job, and another, Dan Rather, will follow. And anyway, the person who sits here is but the most conspicuous member of a superb team of journalists, writers, reporters, editors, producers, and none of that will change. Furthermore, I'm not even going away. I'll be back from time to time with special news reports and documentaries, and beginning in June, every week with our science program, Universe. Old anchormen, you see, don't fade away. They just keep coming back for more. And that's the way it is. Friday, March 6th, 1981. I'll be away on assignment, and Dan Rather will be sitting in here for the next few years. Good night.
Great.
This has been the CBS Evening News.
With Walter Cronkite. Oh. How about those days?
Great.
And you know, he went on to live. That was in 1981. He went on to live till 2009 and died at the age of 92. An era that we'll never see again. Because even though Dan Rather took over, he basically ended his career with a scandal reporting. He was the godfather of fake news, the guy who replaced the great Walter Cronkite. But he's still out there, Dan Rather. He's still out there active all over social media, not remembering how his career came to a horrible, horrible end. And that's the way it is on this March 6th, 2024. Good evening from the TBSN. Jim?
If anybody, Tony, if anybody's interested in the 1950 Phillies, I just released something about the 1950 Phillies. It was like a special done, I guess, over 25 years ago. And I just
is it on the Facebook page?
It's on my go to JJS Archives, and you can see it up there.
So on
I think
Facebook.
People enjoy it.
YouTube.
On YouTube, JJS Archives.
Archives.
Yes.
And that's where this is all the material that you have compiled. And it's not just Tony Bruno stuff. It's all the great audio stuff that you
compiled.
Yeah, this
was probably the best thing ever done on the 1950 Phillies. And unfortunately, all the people that were on that special are not with us anymore.
Exactly.
Al Meltzer was the host. And they had Robin Roberts and Kurt Simmons and people like that. And unfortunately, they're not with us anymore. But
exactly.
I think people enjoy if you're really a Phillies fan.
They were called the Whiz Kids.
That's right.
Yeah. And nowadays, the Whiz Kids are people who can't hold their have bad prostates.
Well, it's always amazing the things that you still have, Jim, that nobody else has.
Well, this was off my VCR, then I transferred to DVD, and then I got it into the computer, and then that's how you that's where you go right to YouTube after that. But you had to go through. All the stuff is on my VCR tapes. I must have 80 VCR tapes left.
Now, did you punch out the holes in the back like we did with our porn?
No,
so
I
wouldn't accidentally erase it?
I did. Now, actually, I didn't know how to put the videos on YouTube, but I've now found out how to do it. Now, I'm going to have all kinds of stuff up there now.
Awesome. Well, Jim, you're the best that ever has ever done this. You are the official.
And thank you for saying, give me a plug this morning on 12
Nick Cale. I have to give you love, Jim. I mean, you know, my feelings toward you are genuine because you're a great guy. You know, we went through a lot of technical things because, you know, we're older and you finally got that all straightened out with computers and stuff. But the fact that you went from your VCR tapes, you didn't go beta back in the day, you went VCR. And people were debating beta or DVCR, but you did like I did. Did your VCR always flash like zeros a minute to 12 o'clock? Did you ever have
that
stage?
I had the time set all the time on that. But I keep them in a cool, dark spot that protects the VCR.
That's why I keep Robin in a cool, dark spot,
kind of
and it protects her, too.
Any light and heat destroys it.
Exactly right. Especially the humidity. You know, it's not
and
the heat, Jim.
Realize,
it's the humidity.
Tony,
gets you all the time.
This is my 20th year on your show this year. So
wow.
20 years. We have to do a special anniversary show later.
August. Yeah, I think August 2004 I came on the air for the first time.
That is so awesome. Well, Jim, thank you again, once again, for bringing us the great stuff.
And people are saying that they subscribe.
I hope you start getting unfortunately, yesterday, the replay of YouTube was that your show was on YouTube's replay yesterday for some reason.
Awesome.
I know. Well, it's because.
It wasn't because I played too much music. And YouTube, which is a channel that has all the music videos, pulls down our show where we're licensed to play music videos. That's what I don't understand. I'm going to take this all the way to the Supreme Court, and I'm going to get lawyers from all over America to perform for free, absolutely free. I'll get Dan Lust on this. How the hell can we get pulled down from YouTube when we are BMI ASCAP licensed? And also, YouTube provides all the videos that we play.
Yeah.
So explain that. I'm just looking for a simple explanation.
It makes no sense
Does that
whatsoever.
Make any sense to you, Jim? I'm looking for common sense.
Fortunately, you can pick up the replay on No Filter yesterday.
Yes.
Exactly right.
There are replays available, and I we'll see now what Rumble does.
Yeah, because people are saying we look good on Rumble today.
So hopefully Rumble will keep us up there, and if you need to see the replay, you just check all these different places because sometimes we're taken off, and sometimes we're not.
BB Films, is it BB Films
with
a Z?
BB Films says, I subscribe, Jim. So
and he says, put all those Radnich and Bruno audio up there on your channel because the people in the Bay Area still love it. Yeah, I would rent Blockbuster videos, record over them with footage of me doing naked jumping jacks and then return it to the next unsuspecting video. No, I had my own. Remember, you can get those VHS tapes in like a 3-pack for like $3.
Do they even sell them still?
I don't know. They're probably like $20 a piece now, right?
Go to the internet, you can get them.
You can get anything on the internet, Jim.
Yeah.
I know. That's where I get most of my, because a lot of the stuff is not sold in these stores anymore, like DVD, blank DVD tapes. I have to go to the internet and get
it's
them.
It's an outrage. I got a ton of DVDs in the garage. I'm sure they're all melted by now.
Yeah, probably.
A lot of them are homemade porn, too, so I got to make sure I get those transferred over to DVD. You never want to lose those.
You don't want those to melt.
That's like having, pictures of your kids. These are things that you never want to forget.
It's exactly the same as
you never want to lose.
Pictures of your children. You're right.
I remember when you used to give away them on your
exactly
box,
right
you know.
Because
not
I'm
the homemade stuff.
I'm the original, not the homemade stuff. No, you had to pay extra for that. And when I get all these things transferred, I may have a separate channel so that I will show people the world that I ain't bullshit when I talk about my whoring years.
Oh, you could open up your own OnlyFans account with all of your vintage home movies.
Exactly right. I'm going to tell you, you'll be impressed, ladies and gentlemen. And guys, she'll like it too, as Frank Thomas says on those dick pill commercials, The Big Hurt. Talking about The Big Hurt.
Jim, can't wait. Can't wait till the next time.
Okay.
Thanks,
Jim. Bye.
There he is. Stay safe.
Okay,
there
guys.
Is the great Jim from Cheltenham.
Take care, everybody.
Archivist. Subscribe to that channel.
We have somebody who's been waiting for a while. We have Frank from...
Oh, where did Frank go?
No, that was my fault, Frank.
Damn it, Robin.
Damn it.
Did you hang up on him?
I did. Hold on.
You have one job.
God, I've done that once before.
Jose calls in. Everybody calls in. Yes, my favorite
VHS
was
back. That my was my
you're
back.
Right. This was the era. Remember when I was younger, my kids, the original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and now they keep making more and more. They have the animated ones. They had the live action ones.
Okay.
But my favorite VHS was the 10-inch Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Frank.
Those were awesome. Let's go to Frank. Not Frank the Tank. Frank, what's going on today, man?
What's going on, Tony? How are you?
Beautiful, man. Beautiful.
I was like, man, you're hanging up on me already? I know my phone connection was horrible last time, but jeez.
No, that's Robin. You got to blame Robin.
That was me.
I had to give her one of these right now. I'm sorry. I don't like doing it, but.
It's all good. No, hey, I was a little too upset to call in yesterday, obviously, because with Jason retiring and. Got to give a shout out to Robin for calling it because I did not think there was no way I thought he would retire.
You and me both, because he's still out there doing stuff. And
I called it.
But Robin did call it, and I gave her love for that. She didn't bet on it, of course, but
we
should have won some damn money, Robin. If you're going to have a lock, I can bet on it. You can bet on whether Jason Kelce was going to retire.
Well, you should have listened to me.
Well, I didn't go to my Hard Rock Bet app. Need to win some damn money.
I saw it in his wife's eyes. It was a locked as far as I was concerned.
By the way, did you see what he did? He's been doing stuff. He was out at the Flyers game, and then he did this video. I'm sure he did it before he retired. The one where he jumped on a flaming folding table.
Oh, I missed that one.
Did you see that? When he did it with his brother for the podcast, he's standing on top. Then there's fire trucks nearby. So he has, obviously, a safety suit on. So... And, the Bills Mafia, these guys go into folding tables all the time. So he had a folding table on fire. And then he jumped. See if you can find that video, Robin. And then Jason Kelce, look up a New Heights podcast, because that's where they put all this
opening.
Stuff. Yeah, that's their and it's obviously a great podcast. How could I not know he was retiring? Come on, man. Yeah. It was so obvious. I don't think it was obvious after his last game.
No. And it scares me a little bit because, I mean, the fact that he didn't come back, in his mind, he's got to be thinking they're not going to be better than they were last year because he's so close. I mean, this team was so close to being a Super Bowl contender, if not winning one. Maybe he's thinking he can't catch Travis in Super Bowls now, and that's why.
No, I don't think that. I think they obviously, if you've seen them, I mean, they respect each other. I mean, he went to Kansas City to be with his brother when they played in the Super Bowl, and so I don't think there's any of that. You know, the good thing is at least Jason got one. You know, obviously Travis and the Chiefs are a dynasty, and who knows how many more they're going to get. You know, who knows how long Travis wants to play. But the best thing about these guys is that you can tell. They're genuine brothers. They love each other. Put all that other stuff with the relationships and all that stuff and the what's her face. Yeah. You know, that's stuff that attracts a lot of non-football fans, and it was good for the game, and it obviously brought a lot of eyeballs to football. But those guys are about family, you know, and you can see it. The mother, you know, what Jason was talking about, his family, his mother and father. I mean, that's legit. I mean, this wasn't some theatrical performance. It was legit. Now, he wrote it down because he had a lot of people to thank, but you could tell when he was reading that statement the other day that was all heartfelt. And to me, the thing that was the most impressive to me, not just talking about his wife and his family and his talking about Jeff Stoutland, his offensive line coach, and how he was the guy who pretty much after the 2016 season, when he admittedly had a horrible year and people were talking about, get him out of here, he's shot. Remember that? And Jeff Stoutland's the guy who brought him back in the mental framework so that he would go out there and play better. And then he emerged, you know, as a stone-cold, guaranteed lock Hall of Fame center. And anybody who debates that is clueless. And I think he's going to be first ballot. I think he's going to be first ballot Hall of Famer.
If he's not, it would be a crying shame because I think there's only like four or five centers in the Hall of Fame anyway.
Yes, exactly.
And he's the best of all time. And Jeff should be considered, I think, at this point, the best offensive line coach that's ever done it, because you watch that offensive line, it's not just because they're talented. It's great coaching.
Absolutely.
Their awareness is great. They're always picking up the stunts and picking up formations. It's just great. And Jason is just an embodiment of what Philly is.
Exactly.
And he's going to be missed. He's going to be missed.
Well,
but,
you know what? He's not going to go. And the thing about Jason Kelce is that you'll see him everywhere. He'll be at the shore. He'll be bartending. I mean, that's what's great. People run into him all. Rob and I used to run into him all the time at the PetSmart. South Philly.
Yep.
We would see him with his wife and the dogs. You know, he had the kids at home because they were young. But, no, he's a regular guy. And that's what people want to see because a lot of the people you see in sports or in entertainment, you know, they portray themselves as regular guys, and many of them aren't. It's an act. And I don't have a problem with that. I mean, some superstars can't walk around and they don't want to be bothered because they get swarmed. But Jason Kelce's one of those guys now. If he walks around, he's like the Pied Piper. Everybody sees him and loves him no matter where he goes. So he's not one of those, he's just a Philly guy, you know, sucking up to Philly. I mean, people in other cities see Jason Kelce. They watch the documentary. You know, they've seen him doing his thing.
Mm-hmm.
And he's impossible to dislike no matter who you root for. That's what makes him special. He's impossible to dislike. And how many athletes can you say that about?
You can't. And he's a great representative of the sport.
Yep.
He's got an old school approach with a new school attitude. And it's something that needs to be hopefully carried on by the youngsters that he had, you know, tutelage over throughout these years.
Yeah, the Cam Jurgens and the guys that they've drafted, yes. Absolutely.
Exactly, right. And if you're looking at this team now, because you got to think Fletcher Cox is going to leave too, which I'm not too worried about because I think we have the depth there in that position. But the big rumor right now is that they're going after the running back from the Giants, Saquon Barkley. And what a slap in the face it would be to the Giants if the Eagles are able to pick him up. And I know they have more pressing issues on the defensive side. They need to go after some secondary guys.
Absolutely.
Getting C.J. Gardner-Johnson was back. I think everybody knew C.J. was coming back. But to pick up Saquon Barkley, I think that's the player they got to get.
Well,
just for
I don't know. We'll
purposes.
See, because they're making they have to make a decision because it's next week. Monday the 11th is when the free agent period opens where you can talk to a player. You can't officially sign them to the 13th. So a week from today, we will know about many of these free agents and where they're going to go. And these teams already know who they want. So we'll find out later on in the week and next week. Great call, Frank. Appreciate you checking in, buddy.
Thanks, Frank.
There he is, Frank. Meanwhile, just checking.
We're coming right back.
Yes, we're allowing the stations to identify themselves.
Yes, and when we come back, the fabulous Defoe, a.k.a. Jeff DeForest.
Jeff DeForest. We'll go across from the west coast of Florida to the east coast. The man who pretty much runs all of Miami's sports media. The only people that has credibility in Miami anymore. The great Jeff DeForest. We'll talk all kinds of assorted stuff, including a man who used to roll with the 7th floor crew himself, Jeff DeForest. He's coming up, Luigi, later on. And Scam Likely, ladies and gentlemen, is calling me, so I got to take this call from Mr. Scam Likely, my best friend, and then we'll be right back in just a matter of seconds. So don't go anywhere.
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno on the Tony Bruno's.
Another public service announcement from Brill Cream. Men, beware. Use one dab of Brill Cream. Just a little dab makes your hair look excitingly clean, disturbingly healthy. This man dared to use two dabs. Now he's in trouble. We refuse to be responsible.
Brill Cream, Brill Cream, Brill Cream. Brill Cream, a little
dab will do ya. Brill Cream, you look so better there. Brill Cream, the gals will offer to ya. They'll love to get their fingers in your hair. Now back to the biggest sports network on the planet, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Midnight in the desert, shooting stars across the sky.
That break was so quick, I couldn't even blow my nose. Block what number? Oh, I block all the Scam Likely people. But they still keep finding me. I thought he was a good personal friend. I always feel bad hanging up on him. It could be something interesting, you know, like car insurance or what else do they sell you? Your warranty's expiring.
Dick pills.
Dick pills.
I love that when they call and they say, Canadian pharmacy.
Yeah, Canadian pharmacy, eh?
Hey.
You know, speaking of Canadians, big trades in the National Hockey League today. We'll run down some of them, including the Flyers making a deal, you know, making deals, signing players, getting rid of players. The New York Rangers in the NHL trading deadline day. They have, they're trading for Seattle Kraken center Alex Wennberg. Now, remember, we told you the other day that Wennberg was not playing and because they were going to trade him. So they did it. The Friday is the trade deadline. So the Rangers have been looking for multiple forwards since the trade deadline to replace Philip Chytil and Blake Wheeler, both out for the rest of the season. Now, let's go to a man who's he may be like me and an older gentleman, but he's active. As they say, how about them, as Kenny Mayne used to say on SportsCenter, let's go to the seniors. They're seniors, but they're still active when talking about the old seniors tour, which is no longer called the seniors tour because the great Jeff DeForest, we know that calling people seniors is now somehow not politically correct. Are you offended when people refer to you as a senior?
It's an outrage.
Yes.
I mean, why don't we just call this show the geezers at Caesars, Tony? What are you talking about here?
Why didn't I think of that when we're in Vegas? Well, weren't there a bunch of fights at Caesars? Yeah, wasn't there always a bunch of fights out at Caesars where they'd be old guys, like when George Foreman was coming back and he'd fight another old guy, and they called it the geezers at Caesars.
Geezers at seniors, Caesars. It was Foreman and Jerry Cooney, I believe, answered to a trivia question. The great Jerry Cooney, who had the one big fight there against Larry Holmes, and after that, unfortunately, fell on. I guess he didn't really fall on hard times, but no, it's good to be here, because the last time we spoke, I think I was looking more like Chuck Wepner, circa around 15, Cleveland, Ohio, against the great Muhammad Ali in those ugly brown shorts with the blue stripe, with no chance to do anything but maybe fall down. And it's good to be back because rumors that I'm a shot fighter turned out to be widely, false.
That's right. You have not been taken to the glue factory. If they still do, they still take them to the glue factory. And where is said glue factory?
They run them at Beulah Park in a stakes race. That's what happens.
Well, Jeff, the Florida Panthers have made a big trade today too.
Oh,
and your
wow.
Florida Panthers over there, and you know, you talk about teams that have just absolutely been on fire. The Florida Panthers, you know, they just made a trade today for the Ottawa Senators winger Vladimir Tarasenko. How about that?
Oh my God, they got Tarasenko the Terrible. That'll put him right over the top. They're playing great. It's been a strange organization, Tony. I don't know how closely you followed the Florida Panthers. I know you were immersed in Philadelphia and
no,
LA,
I've been following
the
Panthers. I followed hockey for a long, long time. I mean, religiously.
Yeah.
The last couple of years, you know, with all the expansion and, you know, not paying attention to all the national sports when I wasn't doing a national show, you know, I can't name, like, and when I got the job at ESPN, they would ask you to name, like, the third line for the Vancouver Canucks to make sure you knew what you were talking about. Now, you know, most people, and I still love hockey, and I pay attention to it. Trades happen, the standings, you know, the good teams, the bad teams, the rag teams. Now, wasn't that, what was that movie? Ragtime, the good times.
Ragtime, yeah.
Yeah, the good times.
It's a tough league to follow, though. Nobody knows what's going on there. I mean, when you came on and you started talking about the Flyers and all of these deals and Tortorella, I was thinking, who am I talking to? Fucking Don Cherry here? Just
Well, no, I don't have any of those wide collars and those great – I mean, Don Cherry. Is there a better-dressed man as a sports analyst ever in the history of any sport?
He's a Canadian Haywood Hale Bruin. I mean, the guy, definitely has a distinct style. But, he's the resident authority. I mean, everybody always references Don Cherry. And, a lot of people don't like his shtick because he's highly critical of players and things like that.
Exactly.
Which I kind of like. It reminds me of an old school L.A. guy that you may have been familiar with. I don't know if you remember the great late Jim Healy.
Oh, yes,
who used
absolutely.
To light it up. I mean,
absolutely.
He had every radio in Los Angeles tuned in at 520 on KLAC, some country butt-fuck station that somehow everybody tuned into for sports because Healy was on for 10 minutes, and the guy was brilliant.
Absolutely.
One of the real, not just pioneers like you, Tony, but the guy that, you know, definitely set the pace and changed the way people looked at doing sportscasting and sports reports. Really a brilliant, brilliant guy. But nobody knew what was going on in Florida in hockey. And we still are stunned that this team is in first place overall. And my favorite move that was ever made by the Florida Panthers was Gerard Gallant must be one of those real true hockey hard-ons, right? Where he always has like a couple of good seasons with a team and then they fire him inexplicably, like in the middle of the year. And in the case of the Panthers, he was doing pretty well with them. And all of a sudden, they're in like Saskatchewan or someplace where you need snowshoes in the summertime just to go to, the local bars. And they left him like in a snowdrift in the middle of Saskatchewan while they were on a road trip and just fired the guy unceremoniously. And then the lasting image, I think there was a picture in a paper of Jaromir Jagr, who was with the team at the time, going, "Hey, Jerry, you want your shit?" And they threw his duffel bag out and left him there. They do weird stuff in the NHL. I mean, it's hard to follow, and, you just never know exactly what the philosophies of the various organizations are, although the Panthers, surprisingly, I mean, they have been great. And I have never been more dead wrong about a coach in my lifetime than I was about Paul Maurice, the guy that's behind the bench right now for the Panthers. Because we thought he was vapid and void of all personality. He never said anything. He happens to be, even though he's got a lot of wins, he's the losingest coach in NHL history, has the most losses of any coach that's ever been behind the bench there. And it started out not so famously with the Panthers and Paul Maurice. And we labeled him the French Joe Philbin, if you can imagine anything more insulting than that. Talk about a guy that had like zero impact. You're asking yourself, how did the owner, Stephen Ross, stay awake during the interview? And then Paul Maurice turned out to be like this brilliant guy. All of a sudden, he's the resurrection of Toe Blake. He's got this team playing fantastic hockey. He got them in the finals last year. They had legitimate reasons to lose to the Las Vegas Golden Knights. A, probably Las Vegas was a better team. And B, half of their guys had like broken backs.
Exactly.
They only tell you like it's an upper body injury. They don't tell you that the guy is having like, you know, his arm chopped off tomorrow in some hospital. So, yeah, I mean, this guy's done wonderful things. And it's a big surprise to see them and playing so well, because this is usually the time of the year where we've already discussed mathematical elimination a couple of times. So nice to see the franchise doing well.
No, absolutely. There's no doubt about it. And everybody realizes how. And it was my honor a couple of years ago to emcee the Florida Sports Hall of Fame dinner out there at Trump National. Yeah, at Doral a couple of years ago.
Nice.
They asked me, and one of the great local goalies who played for the Florida Panthers was inducted because of his time with the Florida Panthers, the great Roberto Luongo.
Luongo's great.
Yeah, great guy, big guy, funny guy, and obviously another Florida Hall of Famer. Now, speaking of Florida Hall of Famers, because I know you are Mr. Miami. In fact, people are saying...
Yeah, actually, you have I'm assuming this is one of your longtime fans who's listening in as well, saying his name is Juan Cristobal
Sarasua Batanco.
Yes. Defo is a Miami legend, a character, and genius.
Absolutely.
It's Defo.
Yes, he happens to be my bookie, and he's probably looking for the 250 that I lost when Lipscomb got eliminated from the A-Sun tournament last night. What kind of a Fugazi bullshit result was that, Tony?
You bet on Lipscomb last night? Lipscomb?
I bet Lipscomb every year to win the NCAA tournament. One of these years, they're going to do it.
There are no Chaminade now. I mean, you got to go back to the great Chaminade days.
Yeah, no, I'm only betting them because, you know, anybody with a name like Lipscomb, I mean, outside of Big Daddy, you got to figure maybe they got some game. And so I bet them, and they lose. And ironically, a guy that beat them with a buzzer shot for Northern Alabama was a former Lipscomb star for 3 years. KJ Johnson did me in last night.
Wow.
And so there's no
shot
of them making the tournament now. And all of that money, that preliminary money, went up in smoke. So that was ugly. And then, of course, I bet against Caitlin Clark getting 17 points the other night, even though she had that in the first quarter. Is she the real deal? I mean, what do you think about this, Tony? I mean, should that record be considered separately? Miss Robin, I mean, feel free to weigh in.
Listen, I love her. She's an amazing story.
Yeah.
She just signed a deal with Panini today. And, you know, when I saw she signed with Panini, I said, man, I can go for a nice Panini right now. And Lipscomb, did they at least make a nice sandwich at Lipscomb? Do they make a nice ham, you know, brisket on rye at Lipscomb?
I don't know where the hell it is. You know what? I think it's in Tennessee somewhere. But I bet them every year $100. I'm out like 11 dimes.
You know, Defoe, we were actually just talking about Kalen the other day on the show because, I mean, you have mixed emotions, right? It's so amazing what she is doing. However, that they're making her out to be like, this is the first woman who's ever... Well, no, it's not. And it's not comparing apples to apples. First of all, before the NCAA...
Yeah, we knew the AIAW.
Right. Rose Pearl.
But she was in a small... The problem with this, Defo, as everybody has read by now, is that, you know, had women playing, the woman, obviously, whose record she broke, who was a legend and had the record in major college football, who played for the Harlem Globetrotters, Lynette Woodard. I mean, you know, she was a legend. And even she said, you know what, you got to give it up to Caitlin Clark. But the whole thing about the record of Pistol Pete Maravich, he only played 3 years because you weren't eligible as a freshman, and there was no three-point shot. So as much credit as I give her, to call her the all-time leading scorer in basketball history, I think is not fair.
Right.
To the people who played when there was no three-point shot.
Right.
But that's what we have to live that way. The AIAW records are acknowledged for coaches, but they're not acknowledged for some players. So that's where there's a whole mess up, whether they do a cumulative thing, you know, like the NBA and the ABA. At least when they have a Hall of Fame, it's the Basketball Hall of Fame. So they acknowledge both ABA, NBA, college, and even like Russian basketball stars are in the Basketball Hall of Fame.
Some guy's covered in baklava. He's been playing a turkey. He makes it into the Hall of Fame. They're inducted the same day as Dennis Rodman, a worm who was in the pants, the shorts of Alonzo Mourning for 17 years, grabbing rebounds, working his way into this Hall of Fame stature. I don't know. I mean, Caitlin Clark, to me, I don't know how it was. You grew up, I'm assuming, Tony, in Philadelphia, correct?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. All right. So, I mean, but they played a real brand of basketball there, even on a recreational level. I mean, you know, there was usually money at stake also. So that made it especially intense. And, you knew what you were doing. You had to know what you were doing. But Caitlin Clark would have been a chucker
in
those circumstances. I mean, she would have got the shit beat out of her before she got to her car, even if it was the winning team that was doing it, because she doesn't have a conscience. How can you take this shot from the logo there? I mean, what the hell is happening? And compare this. I know Pistol Pete did the same thing. And if he wasn't playing for his father, he probably wouldn't have played 6 minutes of college ball because nobody would have put up with his shit back in the day. But it's really, I mean, too incomparable. I mean, you can't compare these two things. The women's record with her playing 7 years, longer than John Blutarski was in school. And then Pistol Pete limited to 3 years and three-point shot. It's just two separate categories altogether. So
yeah,
I don't know why people get offended if you want to make that distinction, because I think it's more than fair.
Exactly.
I totally agree. And I mean, again, she's amazing, but you're not comparing apples to apples. And
it's not her fault that the numbers were there. And of course, the media has to make a big thing. And it's hard to hate her. I mean, anybody hating her is
she's
just moronic. She's doing what she's supposed to do, and she goes out and shoots the basketball. I mean, she's no Max Strus, who can do it from 60 feet for the Cleveland Cavaliers from way downtown. Boom. I mean, that was an unbelievable shot. And even though he was out last night, he beat your ball. Well, they're not your Boston Celtics. They're, of course, Pete Shepard's Boston Celtics. But the
Pete's
NBA.
Pete's got to be shaken, though.
Yeah.
When do they just fucking collapse already, Tony? Everybody is waiting for this. When is Porzingis going to be? I mean, you're not rooting for a guy to get injured unless you're from Philadelphia.
No, listen, I don't root against the Celtics. They're an amazing franchise.
How long can this go on, though, Tony? I mean, how is it possible that they have, like, no injuries, nothing? And then if you look at their bench, beyond the starting five, maybe six players, don't they look like the scrubs from the Washington Generals, these guys? Who are these guys?
Now you're going to get Pete Shepard all pissed off that we're picking on the Boston Celtics. The Boston Celtics right now, they're the best team in the NBA. I mean, who's better?
No doubt. Nobody's better, although ESPN would have you convinced that the Lakers will meet the Warriors in the Western Conference Finals with the winner to go on and easily cruise to the championship.
I think they already have that scheduled. They already have that on there. When you look ahead to April and May, when we'll be giving a crap about the NBA playoffs because we'll be thinking about going out on the boat, although we can do that all the time down here, and that's the advantage, as you know, Deepo.
Oh, it's a beautiful thing,
And you know the Miami Beach audiences.
You're on the West Coast, too.
The Miami Beach audiences, as the great Jackie Gleason would say, are the greatest audiences in the world. Remember that those days back in the day on the Jackie Gleason show?
Oh, yeah, no, he was tremendous. When he used to roll around the Inverary Country Club, which is a dump right now. I mean, his place is an armpit of a golf course. It's hard to believe it held that distinction at one time. But the great thing about the West Coast of Florida, Tony, and you and Miss Robin cruising around on a boat, a friend of mine got married over there, and part of the reception was on one of these cruise boats that goes around the intercoastal there and has music and food and everything, and it was great. And I was living on just off the intercoastal here. I had a home just off the intercoastal before various foreclosure proceedings kind of forced me to move into another situation.
That happens. You know, it happens. You should just be a squatter. Now, the new thing is, even if you don't own the place, just go in it and squat and see if they can throw you out.
Well, it was great. I mean, my dad used to tell me, and this was 2008, he said, the good news, DeForest, is you own four homes, and the bad news is you own four homes, which all became worthless subsequent to me making these major investments. I always get in on everything at the exact wrong time. A witness my $100 loss again this year on Lipscomb.
Yeah, I mean, but,
I was living in some pretty palatial digs, and then I go to the West Coast there. I take this tour of the Intercoastal where it's all rich people from Ohio. It's all Ohio State graduates. They own all the homes there on the beach and
You're
everything
right.
else that's over there on the
You're
West Coast.
Absolutely right. And now all the Germans. And they, There's so like it's like Germany down here.
It is.
And again, it's these people come here, you know, because it's less expensive than living in Berlin or Hamburg or.
Cape Coral und Fort Myers is wunderbar.
Wunderbar.
It's holy Heidi Fleiss. What's happening here, man? Let me find the pool with Charlie Sheen over there. But the waterways over there and the houses on the intercoastal made the East Coast over here, which is supposed to be so great. And the international tourist place, it looked like a waterfront ghetto compared to what's going on over there. I mean,
by the way, Pete Shepard is checking in.
You guys are living in some palatial digs over there.
Pete Shepard checking in on the live stream, Jeff, and he's saying, default for three. Got it. So, I mean, even Pete respects your greatness and your
legendary status. And we have to clarify something here. Another person, Philadelphia Public School, saying, did Defoe and Luby leave TBSN? No, they did not. So Luby ended up having to leave because he had scheduling conflicts. Defoe, you had a health issue that you had to take care of, and it was very difficult to do shows. So you took a leave of absence, and now
you were on like rip bags for like 2 months, right?
Oh, it was unbelievable. I was seeing bugs while I was doing the shows, and then Miss Robin would remind me, "Hey, you forgot what you were talking about." I'm like,
she does that to me every day. That's what I do too.
That's not uncommon anymore. Yeah,
it's like
we consider
that
a positive mental health situation. By the way, a startling revelation of the hour, Tony, and I had to drive my wife somewhere and then wait for a few minutes in the car. I tune into the show there, and the Village People really were gay. I almost fell out of the driver's seat.
Who knew? Talking
about the Village People.
Well, I mean, YMCA, if you didn't look at the lyrics, I mean, everybody loves the song. And that's the thing about gay people. I mean, you know, we didn't care that Liberace was gay or, you know, or Barry Manilow, even if you suspected it. Nobody cared. And now all of a sudden we were obsessed with it. I mean, it's just a preference. Not preference by L'Oreal, which, of course, Robin endorses, including her new lipstick by, what shade is that, Robin? It's a very, very red lipstick. Can you
get
people
them to buy
know.
Some spots? Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. We'll have Robin do the endorsement there. That'd be great.
Robin's whipping out a tube right now.
I always liked the guy with the Native American headdress guy was always my favorite. I mean, you didn't know if it was Jay Silverheels, Danny Little Red Lopez, or, some guy that was just with another singing group. And I had the pleasure of introducing them in an armory at West Orange, New Jersey. Prior to the Super Bowl, not right prior to the game, but the Wounded Warriors, our good friend Chris Visser was staging these Wounded Warrior games.
Yep.
And so they held it in West Orange. They found a place there. They had a bunch of nondescript Philadelphia Eagles players on hand from the distant past. Who was the guy they made that movie about that was like he walked onto the
great
team?
Vince Papale, Invincible.
He was there. He was there, and a very nice guy, a real gentleman.
Great guy. He lives in Jupiter, by the way. Everybody's moving. Even Vince lives over in Jupiter now.
Yeah, and they had some professional wrestlers there of some acclaim. And then the Village People, of course, and they stole the show. I mean, they knocked it right out of the gymnasium.
Wait a minute. The Wounded Warrior game had halftime entertainment back then? Because I played in a lot of those. Kenny Mayne would quarterback. Ron Jaworski would come out.
Kenny Mayne was big. Yeah. He had the big knee brace. I don't think there was nothing wrong with his knee. He just wore the brace so he would look cool.
No, he had
he was always great like that.
You know the story, right? You know that Kenny Mayne was the backup quarterback to Randall Cunningham at UNLV.
Yes.
People didn't know that.
That was great. And he was getting inside information from Tarkanian about whether or not Lloyd Daniels was going to be able to play that night.
He was in the hot tub.
Academic considerations.
He was in the hot tub with the famous Richard the Fixer Perry back in the day. You remember those days, right?
That would be a nice piece of inside information, wouldn't it? I mean, if you were in there with the fixer and had the goods on that guy, it'd be great. But I didn't realize you played in some of those games. You weren't in this one, though.
No, I haven't. Now, they stopped doing them because one of the great people that's there, a gentleman in the wheelchair who used to work at ESPN with me.
That guy was great.
I keep forgetting his name, but he's a great, great guy. He's now doing his own thing. He's got his own channel on the Disability Channel. So he does podcasts every day. He's a great guy. Lost both of his legs. He's in a wheelchair.
Yes.
And the guy's an amazing athlete. And when you play against those Wounded Warrior guys, you know, they come right at you, man. You know, they don't want any sympathy. They'll knock you on your ass. And that was the great thing about playing them.
Yeah, he was fantastic. I mean, he was tackling the actual current football players. And he looked like Micah Parsons out there, man. He was absolutely amazing, this guy. And who was going to mess with him? You know, I mean, it just he was a real inspiration. So I'm glad to hear that he's still involved and doing well. But yeah, that was it. That was one of the highlights, one of my musical highlights of my lifetime.
That's awesome.
Introducing the Village People, ladies
now,
and gentlemen.
Were they the original?
Here they are,
were they
the
original
people.
Cast, or did they have replacement players like
no,
they did back
no,
in the strike
all
era?
All the original guys, they were all dead as a doornail, I think. The original guys were in worse shape than we are, Tony. What are you talking about?
Well, the construction worker now doesn't even have muscles, so you know. I mean, they've really gone to low rent. You know, they can't even find a jacked up construction dude.
Yeah, it's really hard to find replacements there. It's kind of like if you were the Iron Sheik and they lost your luggage, where do you find another pair of those shoes?
Exactly.
You can't just walk into some costume shop. Now you're fucked for the entire gig. I mean, you can't even go out there and embarrass yourself. McMahon's going to find you. I mean, what are you supposed to do?
By the way, what's this guy's name? Go down a little bit, Robin. Robin's red lipstick reminds me of the cartoon that used the real mouths on Clutch Cargo, G-Man Music. Remember Clutch
that
Cargo?
That was a great cartoon.
Yeah.
Yes.
No, but none of the characters moved except the lips. And they
the
were
lips
just,
moved. That was
the
it.
The lips moved, yeah.
Dave Stevens.
It was like a politician.
The Wounded Warrior player is Dave Stevens.
Dave Stevens.
Yeah.
That's right. He's a great
guy.
Follow him
guy.
On social media. And now he has his own channel on the Disability Channel.
Mm-hmm. No, he's fantastic. And, you know, a real inspiration, as you said. I mean, you meet the guy and you see what he's doing. And you're complaining about little stuff that happens to you on a daily basis. And you realize, hey, there's a lot more to this than... And, you know, just fetching and screaming and whining about, you know, the fact that your meal came 5 minutes late to the table.
And by the way, not my style to criticize, but while we're on the story, they would not allow him inside the corral in Las Vegas at Super Bowl Radio Row because they were allowing, you know, like the people who work there. But since he's a disabled guy, and he's been gone to like 35 Super Bowls, they could have allowed him to go in the corral and hold his microphone up to get interviews like a lot of the other people did. And I thought that they did him wrong, and I was angry about it. And he went to the NFL and said, why are you doing this to me? You know, I'm disabled. I've been here as part of the Wounded Warriors. Now I'm on the Disability Channel. He had his own booth there, and they would not let him in there. So I thought that was a bad decision by the National Football.
It's an outrage.
It is an outrage.
You should have brought it up to Roger Goodell. Yeah, I mean, you should have brought it up. Did you go to the press conference?
No, I wasn't allowed. I wasn't one of the chosen 100 people that they handpicked.
Oh, that's right. We talked about that.
Well,
yeah, that
Dave
was crazy.
Steven, here, just a real quick note on Dave. So he had been asking in previous years to have some allowances for him because, you know, you're trying to compete with able-bodied people that are thronging.
Sticking
right
microphones and cameras in there.
He finally just sort of gave up. And our Matt Fowler, who was there, who was also disabled.
Yes.
Is Matt the young intern from FAU?
No. That's a younger kid. Matt Fowler is a veteran guy who's been out in the Bay Area.
Oh, okay.
And he's
the producer for LFG. And so he walks with...
Oh, all right.
He
needs a walker to move around.
He has a walker and has a pretty severe disability. And he went up to somebody, and he did get somebody to allow him a special accommodation to be able to go around to the outside and come through into the corral and ask questions so that he wasn't competing with all these,
And you should do that. I mean, if you're the NFL and you got all these banners in the end zones about ending racism, and it takes all of us, and you put that in the end zones, but you're not allowing disabled people to get equal access to interviews. I mean, that's just ridiculous.
A disgrace, an outrage, as you said. Hey, one other thing, too. How would you like to be this George Patton guy? Not the general, but
the general manager
of the Denver Broncos. Because does that constitute now? Is that possible that might have been the worst trade in sports history? I mean, that was worse than Lou Brock for Ernie Brolio, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Getting Russell Wilson and then paying him all that money and all of these draft picks they gave up and now they find themselves, looking at some Scribini there. I think Sean Payton was talking about, he was mumbling Bubby Brister's name at the combine.
Hey, the great Bubby Brister. I mean, that man matriculated the ball for many franchises back in the
day.
That's
it. Yes, absolutely. But I mean, is it, Tony? I don't know. Is that the worst trade in NFL history?
I haven't broken it down yet, but you got to put that up there. Is it in the, what I love about sports radio, is it in the Mount Rushmore of horrific sports trades? Does it make the top four?
Could be, yeah. I mean, Nolan Ryan for Jim Fregosi. Nolan Ryan still was a little wild when he was acquired. you know, by the Angels. For Gosey, he was a shot fighter, much like I was when I was in that Chuck Wepner mode. But, yeah, I mean, it could be. I don't know.
Steve Carlton to the Phillies in that trade to St. Louis. And who did they trade? Who did they trade to St. Louis for Steve Carlton? That was a bad trade.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't a stiff.
Yeah, no,
it was a pretty good.
It
was a pretty good trade, but obviously the Phillies got the better of that deal because Carlton obviously had, you know, won 27 games with the worst team in baseball.
Steve Carlton trade was in exchange for Rick Wise.
That's right, the great Rick Wise. Rick Wise for Steve Carlton.
Oh, Rick
Carlton.
Wise.
Yes.
Rick Wise is the answer to a great trivia question for Philadelphia people especially. But I happened to be there that day. I was among the 80 million people that were at the Jim Bunning perfect game.
Oh, absolutely.
Father's
yes.
Day.
Yes.
1964, Shea Stadium. I was there.
Were you there?
My father took my brother and me. Yeah, neither my brother or my father were sports fans, but I had asked them if they would mind going to this thing because we wanted to go because it was a doubleheader. You know, right. We were getting two games for the price of one. You actually stayed for both. And Bunning pitches the perfect game in the first game. The Mets sucked, of course, but, you know, you became – started rooting for Bunning around the fifth inning, maybe even earlier. And Rick Wise started the second game for the Philadelphia Phillies that day. Answer to a trivia question, which was won, I believe, by the Phillies either 8-5 or 8-4, something like that.
I don't remember what happened yesterday. How do you remember this? I don't remember yesterday.
Oh, I've made a fortune on that. I mean, I've asked a million people that question for money, and they never get it right. And I happen to be there, and everybody insists they were there, so I know they weren't fucking there because they would have known that Rick Wise started the second game.
Exactly right.
But, yeah, a little obscure minutiae there, you know, that I've cashed on my entire life since.
This is not minutiae. This is called knowledge and experience. This is called having lived. You have to live.
Imagine sitting through a doubleheader now of Major League Baseball. It's hard to get through two innings, even though I love the game. But, yeah, two games, sat through both of them. And Rick Wise started that second game for the Philadelphia Phillies.
And of course,
at what
Jim
point
Bunning.
Do you turn on your own team, though? Yeah, when do you turn on your own team and start rooting for the other guy to get the historical accomplishment? Or would you be yelling, you know, hey, Bunning, fuck you, with 8 2/3 gone?
That's former Congressman.
Choo-choo Coleman,
whoever
was
at that. Kentucky Congressman Jim Bunning to you and me back in the
day.
Yeah,
no, I like Bunning. He was a class guy. There's no question about it. He seemed to have some distinction to him. But, that was always great. You know, you'll never forget it, right? You'll never forget
exactly
your first girl.
Right. Well, yeah. Defo, I'm glad to hear you're back in good spirits and you're healthy again. Are you moving around?
Feeling great, yeah.
You're moving around.
I think the whole thing was a misdiagnosis. Who is that personal injury attorney that you had? Does he do medical malpractice?
Oh, the great Dan Love. No, he does not do. But, you know, there's Morgan and Morgan, and there's all the Farrah and Farrah. Trust me, if you tell people you had a personal injury, they'll be finding you before this segment ends at 5 o'clock here in the East, as we used to say when we were doing national radio.
Well, I may have a case. You call me.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's put your hands together.
Number, Tony, yeah.
We're going to have him back on the Tony Bruno Sports Network very, very soon, hopefully.
I heard Robin's working on it. She's working on my return.
She's working on
excellent.
Everything.
Okay.
The great Jeff DeForest, ladies and gentlemen. Defo!
Guys, it was a pleasure. A pleasure.
Thank you, my
Thank
friend.
You. All right.
Beautiful. There he is, ladies and gentlemen. How great is Jeff DeForest?
I love him.
It's cool talking to somebody in your same age group.
Oops.
And the fact that we're both still alive in our age group is also very, very... But the guy is an encyclopedia. Plus, he's got the dry wit. He gets it. He gets sports radio. He knows who the phonies are. He knows how this industry has changed. And he's another guy, despite having some limitations with technology, which a lot of older people do, he's embraced it. He hasn't embraced debate, because that's the bullshit they used to do on ESPN. Embrace debate! And then the guys would be yelling at you through the TV screen about how much you suck. Most of the time, they're right, but I don't really care. Do you? We're coming back. You won't get fooled again. You'll never get fooled on this show, Robin. I got to get my drumsticks out because this is one of the greatest drum acts ever. We're taking a break, ladies and gentlemen. Coming back, the great Luigi Curto will join us in the 5 o'clock hour, baby.
Here, TBS. Tony Bruno Sports Network.
Make some noise!
The Tony Bruno Sports Network. Download the app. Tell your friends the game is on. TBSN.
Robin, it's happy hour.
I've got to tell you, I've been
racking my brain. Dude, it's 5 o'clock.
I know.
And you're going into a low tempo, a low tempo, down tempo number? This is when we're supposed to crank it.
You're right.
Not
you're
yank
right.
it.
You're right, Tony. You're
and
right.
we got Luigi on. A
well,
man
he's
who's
not
young.
Here
well,
yet.
He's coming on. And to bring a guy on at 5 o'clock when it's time for happy hour.
Here.
And you come in with a low. I'm doing my reverse.
How's this? This is better.
Casey,
right?
I'm doing my reverse Casey Kasem tie right here. We're doing a dead. We're coming out of a dead dog dedication with an up tempo number. We're coming out of a great segment with Jeff DeFarge, and you give us a low tempo, down tempo number. Listen, I love down tempo and deep house when I listen to Sirius XM Chill. But this isn't a down-tempo show, Robin.
Mangled Mushes. Yeah, play some Slayer, Robin.
Slayer? I didn't even touch her.
Now, Joey B is saying, get it back to Robin's lipstick, says the chaps. The chat room wants to know. Now, we have text messages, Tony, too, while we're waiting for Luigi to call in.
Are we utilizing our text line what's his face out there in L.A.?
Joey B saying, Robin and Tony buzzed while doing the show is the best content. Well,
we're not buzzed. We haven't had a sip.
We have not had a sip.
Not one drop of our. Robin was in the groove until
the group.
She just lost it. You talk about buzzkill. You know, no matter what you're doing, whether it's, you know, having a romantic dinner and then somebody says something stupid and then the moment's gone. When you have momentum, whether it's sports, whether it's sexual, whether it's with your kids, momentum. You don't stop the momentum, Robin. You know what I'm saying?
And there he is,
and
folks.
And speaking of momentum, a guy who can go all night long, a man who's been known to do the YMCA on his trivia night programs that he does every week in the greater Philadelphia area, and a man who fortunately was not at Broad and Snyder, nor was he up there at Rising Sun and Cotman earlier today, the great Luigi Curto. What up, yo?
What up, man? I was listening to you guys singing the YMCA earlier, and I was singing along with you guys going, it should be the AARP.
AARP. Hey, it's AARP WOW Wednesdays, by the way. I get an email from AARP.
Right,
not
check,
only, Robin's an AARP member, too. You don't have to be, you have to be 55 to be an AARP.
No.
52? They keep lowering the age.
I'm a member because of you, not because of me.
It's WOW Wednesdays.
Get that
look,
straight, yeah. Mr. Bruno.
No, it's AAA WOW Wednesdays. So
yeah.
I can get a coach bag up to 50% off. I can go to Hobby Lobby and get 40% off. And Samsonite, we need new luggage, Robin. It's AAA WOW Wednesday. 25% off. Samsonite, yes.
What the slogan should have been Samsonite. It travels well.
Yes,
that
it does.
Should have been the slogan the entire time, and it never fucking was.
I know. I don't get it either.
I heard you talking about it earlier. No, me neither. I heard let's just bag it and move on. I heard that you were talking about you're going to be officiating a wedding for Martinez. Which
yeah,
is great.
That's been planned. That's
awesome.
That's been in the works for over a year. Where have you been, man?
Right. I've been here, dude. But what I'm saying is it's great because I also heard that somebody was saying, you know, what are you going to charge him? I said, you said something. He's like, no, I'm not going to charge him anything. You know what I mean? And, you know, obviously I'm not going to charge you at all. But I will say that before you put you guys kiss and everything, I will turn my tablet around and you will be asked 15%, 20%, or 25%. Or
no.
A custom amount. I'm just saying.
No, that's Bush League. It's like when you go in and get a cup of coffee. You
yeah.
pour it yourself and you
yeah,
bring
right.
it to the counter. Are you going to leave a tip for that?
Yeah.
No, of course
Listen,
not.
Hey,
But when it comes to tips at weddings, come on, Luigi, you're Italian, you know how it works. When you go to a wedding, you know, you go around, and then at the reception, of course, the bride and groom used to go around, and the bride would have that silk bag.
Like a
bag.
Pillowcase?
Silk like a pillowcase.
Yeah, everybody.
And then all the goombas and goombas would all put the envelope in there. And then you would leave.
Sometimes they would be stationary.
Yes.
Sometimes they would be stationary, though, at their table.
Yes.
And every now and again, they would get up while you're eating your flounder Florentine. They would come around, and she'd open that bag nice and wide, Tony.
You're damn right.
She'd open that bag nice and wide, man.
By the way, Joey B. wants to know where Luigi's walk-up music is.
He didn't call in right
when
we were coming.
Yeah, I felt cool, man.
I felt cool.
And I'm still trying to get you to tell me. I didn't know if I was
coming in, if you wanted me to call in at 5 or 5:30. And then when you had Depot on, I said, oh, I'm like, oh, he's coming on at 5. And then obviously I'll just pop on at 5:30. So I was waiting for him to finish. No homo.
We run a tight schedule here. This show is timed to the absolute second. And I got to give you one of these, man. I got to give you one of these right now.
What?
I mean, Robin earned one earlier.
What did I do for you to bestow that honor upon me?
You weren't there at 5 o'clock. You weren't there at 5:01, not 5:02.
What are you talking about? Because Defoe was on, dude.
No, Defoe was out before 5 o'clock. Robin had him out.
No, he wasn't. He was out at 5:02.
That's bullshit. Let's go to the tape. I get my progressive. Let me throw the red progressive red envelope. The challenge flag.
Are you throwing the red flag, Tony? Are you throwing the challenge flag? Fucking bring it.
Flounder Florentine. How about Jim Florentine? I should have worn his T-shirt today. The great Jim Florentine.
Tony,
Jim
Florentine.
That would have been great.
You're gonna have to give yourself a bump, bumpty bump.
For what now?
Because he was out at like 5:05.
No, he was.
Yes, he was. Yes, he was.
No, he was not.
So upon further review. Say, I'm sorry, bitch.
I'm sorry, bitch.
There you go. Thank you. On the other side, what's it called?
By the way, our buddy 91Sixer says, Flounder Florentine is Tony's least favorite King Condom Kingdom flavor. You're right about that, man. It's too fishy.
It's still popular with some people, but it's gone out for the most part.
Now, Luigi, you were going to send me the Vaffanculo remix that you wanted to do, and you never did. So I don't know which one it is that you want me to play.
I'm sorry. I was living my life. I apologize. I will effort that over to you immediately. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. Tone, when you were saying about me no longer being in the Northeast, my father, though, lives right around the corner from where that happened.
Up there at Rising
Sun? Like, literally right around.
Yeah, that's what, 5 points, right? That's 5 points, isn't it?
Yeah, he was actually on his way back from a chemo treatment. He had a little bit of, my dad had lung cancer last year, some people know, some people don't.
Is he all right?
He's still doing chemo? Yeah, there's just one little thing that kind of came back, so they had to do like 5 sessions.
Okay.
So this was his 4th out of the 5. Everything seems to be getting much better, so everything should be okay. But he was heading back home when all that was happening.
Wow. So was that like, on a SEPTA bus, too, or was that just in the street?
Both.
Wow.
Yeah. I don't even want to say it's scary because like it's almost commonplace now, and that's what really makes it scary. You know, it's just happening too much. Like I don't understand why all of a sudden SEPTA buses, that the platforms, trains, what have you, have become, you know, the basically the arena for gun violence. I don't understand.
Yeah, I don't either. And listen, I love SEPTA. You know, we used to ride it all the time down to the sports complex.
There's nothing wrong with public transportation. The problem with public transportation is the public. Remember that. There's nothing wrong with the public transportation. The buses and the trains do exactly what they're supposed to do. It's the people that board those things that don't do what they're supposed to do. That's the problem. As well as the fact of SEPTA, sorry, Tony, I'm just, give me one second here. As well as SEPTA, when they were down, a lot of SEPTA police, they were heavily recruiting, Tony, about a month ago. They were saying that we need more police, we need more police. They were offering all the incentive bonuses, yada, yada, yada. And yet, while they were understaffed, they were still operating on platforms and tracks where there was no personnel. So therefore,
you fail to provide safety and security
exactly.
for the public, and you should be liable for those people who were injured, hurt, lost lives, all those things, because if you own something, you have to protect it. And if you offer security and you don't have enough manpower to man those places, you need to shut down the operation at those locations immediately. Immediately.
Yeah,
can't
but what are you going
to
do? I hear you and I agree, but you know, I had people coming at me because I was talking about this earlier. Like, well, how are you going to secure a bus at Broad and Snyder in South Philly, you know, 24/7? Well, they don't run 24/7 anyway.
They don't run 24/7.
But you can't have armed personnel. This isn't like the airlines when they used to have, the Sky Marshal on there. You can't man every bus and trolley.
Yes. You know what? It wasn't, but guess what? Times have changed. And it's basically adapt or die. Because I don't feel safe getting on a bus. I lived in a city my entire life. I've lived in every neighborhood this entire life. Nothing in this city scares me. But getting into a confined space with people who are carrying weapons, who don't give a shit about human life, that's a little bit of a pause for me right there.
No, I hear you, but you know what? I don't know. Nobody has a solution to this. And the politicians in Philly are posting videos of themselves dancing around in Philadelphia City Council while people are being killed every single day on SEPTA buses. I mean, how about saying we got to deal with this instead of worrying about other nonsense that has nothing to do with the safety of the citizens, which the taxpayers pay taxes for them to provide. I mean, you're not asking for something extra. You're asking for the government to provide safety and transportation and water and electricity and streets, you know, that we're not going to cave in on. So that's what happens.
Right.
That's what people want. And the people who want that, and like down here in Miami, you know, the spring break, the people in Miami have had enough. And then DeSantis says he's going to help provide extra police. And the people who are complaining about it are the ones who don't have any businesses. They're not affected by out-of-control people, most of them
Correct.
From out of town, who go to spring break and then bust shit up. You know, so what are you supposed to do? Not have any Law and Order? And by the way, Law and Order is the longest running, most popular show on TV. But if you mention Law and Order in the real world, nobody wants Law and Order except on TV where it runs 24/7.
I was just going to chime in on that. We should get the great Corbin Burton in here immediately to take trial.
Isn't that the show that has a dun dun?
Yes.
Is that Law and Order? We need to have the Law and Order. Dun 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 dun. The dun dun.
So the thing is, like, you can't fix it in one shot. But what you can do is you can start to implement change. Okay, and like that's one thing you can do. So control what you can control. Here's one thing. Number one. You have way too many freaking buses operating on the street. There's not the need for it. There's way too many buses and way too many people to keep safe. Take some of the buses off the street, shorten some of the routes, and then you have a better chance of keeping those people more safe because you don't have so much more people to worry about and more buses. Less buses, less chances of somebody getting shot on a bus.
Yeah, but
that's basic math.
The bottom line is public transportation is necessary, especially in big cities. It's necessary everywhere.
No one's saying taking it away. I'm saying to make it more economical and also make it more safe by not having as many buses out there for people to board to do things on when you can actually condense some of these routes, Tony. Sometimes you see three or four buses going down the street, going down Broad Street. There's four people on three buses.
No, I
I'm
hear
like,
you.
Do we really need
no,
four
I
buses?
Totally hear you,
yeah,
man.
Do we really need that? That's all. That's my thing. And, like, I don't know. You know, it's above my pay grade. It's not my job to sit here and try to figure out a plan. But guess what? Whoever is in that position really needs to do so because it's getting really, really, really out of control. That's the problem. It's getting out of control. And when you have – I'm sorry. And the great AJ San Antonio checking in saying Corbin Burton was L.A. Law, so give me one of those.
Oh, yeah. See, I never watched Law & Order. I'm a Law & Order guy, and I never watched it because I don't want to watch fake Law & Order. I want to watch real Law & Order. And the people who
who
love Law and Order don't love Law and Order. They only love it on TV where it's made up bullshit.
All right. Isn't it, like the great Alanis Morissette once said, Tony, isn't it ironic?
Don't you think?
Don't you think?
Yes.
I mean, seriously.
Yeah, get Chris Nothon. He's not doing anything. Isn't he doing that? Who's the guy that's doing that cable TV show on HBO Max? It's fantasy. No, it's a... Deal or No Deal Island. He was the big guy, Mr. Big. What's his? Is that? That's not Chris Noth, is it? Which guy is that guy? He's doing Deal or No Deal on Island.
No. It's the guy that was married to Sofia Vergara.
Mr. Big.
No, yeah, not Mr. Big. That's not Mr. Big.
I don't know. Those white guys all look the same to me.
I don't have HBO Max because I'm using Pop Vision again. Tony, remember Pop Vision?
I love Pop Vision. Yeah.
Pop Vision.
Not pop-up video.
$17. Not pop-up video. $17 a month.
Joe Manganiello, which I think they're serving down there at the beautiful restaurant on East Passyunk Avenue that we love, down at the very end there. What's the name of that?
Not Noir.
No, the other one down at the end there.
The Chender place. What the hell? Why can't I think of this place?
I know they have the Chender. They have courses. Everything. It's a great place. Is it still open, by the way?
I actually had a date there 3 months ago, and I walked out on a bitch. Literally strutted out of there, dude.
With a chick? You had a date?
Yeah, I had a date, man. Left. Walked right out.
Why?
Left her to pay the check, too, because she was a bitch.
You never take a bitch on the first date to an expensive joint. We're going to drop at least two bills to get
the... Labor 2.
That's right. Great Italian restaurant. Great Italian restaurant.
Nah, man. Couldn't do it. But anyway,
by the way, I have an update from Steve Keeley, who obviously is the best crime reporter, actual mainstream reporter. He says now the police...
I ran next to him at the Broad Street run last year, Tom.
I know. He's a great guy, and he's a great reporter. Philly police sources are telling him that seven people shot in yet another shooting involving SEPTA bus at Rising Sun and Cottman. Lots of Philly police and SEPTA medics on the way. And he had an update that I just saw where... They basically jumped out, and this is Burholm, as you know, Luigi. They jumped out of a Hyundai vehicle at Rising Sun and Cottman. All seven shot appeared to be juveniles. And so this is another one of those retaliation things where kids in a car with, by the way, a paper license plate, because they get these Delaware tags and then just put them on there because nobody pays attention to license tags and nobody can trace them. And then these kids get out, and they enact retribution against other kids coming out of school, and they bring guns and start shooting stuff up.
That's another thing right there, Tony. You mentioned a license plate, right? Just a couple days ago, who the hell am I? But a couple days ago, I'm literally, like, there's a cop car in front of me, right? Mm-hmm. And then the car in front of them was a little banged up, right? No license plate whatsoever.
Yeah.
Nothing. You think the cop even just attempted to pull them over? No. You have a license plate. Why are you not being pulled over?
Because you're not allowed to pull people over.
Not anymore.
You don't, wait, it's illegal to not have a license plate.
I know it is, Leach. Hello?
Hey.
I know that, but if it's illegal, then you should be able to be pulling someone over.
You can't pull anybody over. What's the matter with you?
That's way too logical.
That's racist.
Speaking of logical, we have somebody north of the border, Gordon from Toronto, Canada.
Hey.
He would like to chime in.
Oh, he's on the line.
He's on the line right now. He would like to chime in on Law and Order, and it will be very interesting to hear from the Canadian perspective as well as what's going on over there. So hang on.
Get in here, you hoser. Come on.
Gordon, you are on the air.
What's going on, Gordon? What's going on up to our great neighbors to the north?
Oh, hey, Tony. Hey, Luigi. It's not too dissimilar situation what's going on down south there. And Luigi, sound like you're pretty fired up, and I'm fired up as well. And the main thing that's firing me up is the fact that I'm looking right now. I'm on the YouTube, I'm on the Rumble, I'm on the Facebook. On the Rumble, Tony's only got seven people watching.
Are you kidding me? Well, we're new to Rumble. We just went on today.
He's only got seven people watching. So this is a grand total of 48 viewers. This guy used to be a real radio guy, Luigi. Do you remember when he was the real deal guy, when he used to actually have a voice? What's going on here, brother?
We are starting a new operation, and people are finding out about it every day, and we don't have millions of dollars to promote it, so we do it on different social media channels.
Sorry, I dropped him.
And he's obviously a faker, right?
He was a faker.
He's the guy that called before.
I think so.
And he's not from Canada.
He's not from Canada. What an asshole.
Yes, he is. He is an asshole. A?
Most people from Canada are.
Well, not all, not all.
No, I don't even know if he's from Canada.
No, he's not from Canada. He's a strapper. He's a strapper.
I think people do. I think it's difficult for people to understand that sometimes. Like when you're switching, when you're switching gears, like you have, and you know you're starting the network, and there's just so many moving parts, and it's so hard just to kind of like you put things out on social media, you put things out here, you put things out there. It takes a little while to get some traction.
And guess what?
Especially when the attention span of a normal human being is one of a gnat, okay,
exactly.
At best. So it's hard for people to, like, when they're scrolling through, they might see your little ad, but they don't know what it. They don't have any idea what it's about. They're not clicking on it because they're moving on to the next thing. It's hard to have someone's attention. It really is.
You're exactly right. By the way, I just saw somebody posted this: the greatest movie review ever, and this was back in the day. You remember the movie The Silence of the Lambs, Put the Lotion in the Basket,
yeah.
One of the legendary movies?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, of course.
So somebody posted...
It's one of my go-to lines every time someone comes over.
Put lotion in the basket?
It's one of my go-to lines every time a girl comes over. Yep.
Well, you got to moisturize. I mean, you don't want to get ashy and shit, you know what I mean?
That's what I'm saying. It's not a big deal.
So this is the movie review from May 12, 2017, format Prime Video, and it gets one star, misleading, not a single lamb. And so that's why it was called misleading when it was on Prime Video, because there's not a single lamb in the movie, Robin. That is deceptive advertising, and I think we should get Morgan & Morgan for the people. Or if you're here in Florida, you got to go with, who's the other company down here? The Armenian dudes, I think they are.
I don't remember what they're...
Yeah, and by the way, Councilman Thomas...
The Armenian dudes? The Armenian dude? You talking about Marco from Trafulia?
No, not those guys. That's you got them confused. Farrah and Farrah.
That's it.
Farrah and Farrah. Not Farrah Fawcett.
So,
it's Farrah's their last name.
No,
it's
not
a family. Fawcett. It's a family affair. The Farrah and Farrah.
Not Farrah Abraham, former MTV mom turned porn star.
That
Farrah
is
Abraham.
Great porn star knowledge right there, man.
Yeah, man. You know, we're talking about the Oscars and the Academy, the Oscars, Academy, you know, winning Academy Awards and having like the betting odds on them. And you were saying like, and you had your call in to Gary Radnich, right?
Yes.
Jim from Sheldon played that, right?
Yeah.
And it was a great call. However, I will say I have one thing about that when people are like, oh, that was the greatest call. I think I may be able to rival that. And you were there for it. It was the night
call?
I had Robin come in. No, for the Academy Awards when I had the night at the Oscars with Jose.
Oh, yes.
And I had Robin playing all the female leads and Jose playing all the male leads from all the Academy Award wins for best film throughout the last, like, 50 years. And it was one of the greatest freaking shows of all time. Because Robin would open up and she would say something, like, from Jerry Maguire. She'd be like, shut up. And Jose would be like, you complete me, yo. Like, it was fucking hilarious.
Because
really Robin was like really getting into it. Robin went full character, and it was great. Because she was giving like a really good performance, and Jose was just like, line. I was dying. It was so good. It was. I still have that. I still have it on. Have it on my external hard drive.
Do you have it on an old VCH tape that you punched the holes out so it wouldn't be erased?
No, brother. I went reel to reel, man. Real to real.
Damn right. You got to keep it real.
I'm old school.
You ain't got to keep it real. You want to keep it real with me. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
As someone once said.
I hate.
All right, let's get it back to sports.
Oh.
I need your opinion on today's
Jason,
trade
Jason
deadline
Kelsey.
In the National Hockey League. The deadline is Friday. We got a lot of movement in the National Hockey League, and I know you're the go-to guy when it comes to hockey action, yo.
Yeah, end to end, Tony. That's me, brother. As in, I can't wait for this to end, basically. Yeah, come on, Tony. Lay it on me. Did Le Habitat make a move?
No, but your Florida Panthers have landed Tarasenko, the former St. Louis Blue great. Remember?
My mom used to keep that in the cupboard for company when they came over.
You got to have Tarasenko. And you got to have Sanka,
right,
too, to wash it down. Vladimir Tarasenko to you and me. The Senators get a 2024 fourth-round pick that would become a 2026 third-round pick if the Panthers win the Stanley Cup. So Tarasenko gives the Panther a legitimate top-six winger whose playoff experience could Help the club win its first title in franchise history. I will be here for the parade. We're going to go over to the East Coast and then get Roberto Luongo up on a float.
Luongo, yeah.
The great
Roberto Luongo. Up on a float.
He's one of us, as we like to say.
We get Van Beesbrook up there, too.
We get the Bees, and we get all the hockey greats. We'll get Barbie Clark out there. We'll get the boys from the Tampa Bay Lightning. Now, I don't think they'll participate because, you know, they're a rival franchise, a rival organization here in Florida. Yeah.
Didn't, like, Pavel Bure used to play for them, too, I think?
Everybody played for your Florida. By the way, the Colorado Avalanche. By the way, the Flyers have been involved today. The Colorado Avalanche got ahead of the NHL trade deadline rush. They got Casey Mittelstadt from the Buffalo Sabres in exchange for defenseman Bowen Byram, not Byram Som, the late great Phillies announcer back in the day. Not Tom Byron, the great porn star.
Not Lord Byram.
That's great, Lord Byram.
The musician.
Yes, that is awesome.
The musician.
The Avalanche made several other swaps today.
Not Byron Munchausen.
What? It's not a Byron. It's a Byram. Come on, man.
Barrett. I fucked up. I'm sorry.
Yeah, people want to know, is the parade in Fort Lauderdale, Miami, or Miami Beach? That's a good question. We'll have to parade. We'll have to organize our, because, you know, we're great parade people here. We've been to so many of them. But the Avalanche picked up defenseman Sean Walker from your Philadelphia Flyers and a 2026 fifth-round pick for forward Ryan Johansson. And a 2025 first-round pick that is top 10 protected. So you got till 3 o'clock Friday to fine-tune the rosters. How about that? They get that.
A lot of
loved him. I loved when he did Getting Hot, Hot, Hot. Remember that? Wasn't that Ryan Johansson? You get it, Robin?
I think it was.
Dexter Poindexter, his fake name, but his real name was something Johannan.
I don't know.
Johansson.
By the way, I didn't do it as an intro, I found, is this the one you're talking about, Luigi?
This
is the House Mix Vafanculo song.
Let me hear it. Because you got to have a walk-up song, man. You got to have a walk-up song. Let's hear it. Is this a disco remix?
Crack that.
Is this it?
Come on. Yeah, it's got the dance mix. I gotta hear. Did Diplo remix this? Or Tiesto?
I don't know. But we need to
crack
go to break.
Crack it up a little bit. I gotta hear.
Wait a minute. Rob, relax. You can't play 10 seconds of an up-tempo tune and then get out. Yeah.
Yeah, let this. I like this. Yeah, it's the one. This
it's got a good beat.
Is
you can dance
one?
To it. Yeah.
Yeah, it's got a good beat. You can dance to it. I give it a 9.
Are you doing a trivia tonight? You doing a quizzo?
Yeah, man. I'm on the road right now. I got Penny in the back seat chilling.
Beautiful, man. Nothing gets chicks better than bringing your dog to a quizzo night when the hot babes are in the house.
We'll talk to you again on Friday, Luigi.
Listen, I'm dumb, but I ain't stupid. You know what I'm saying?
You're damn right, man. Damn right.
All right. I love you. Bye.
Love you,
too.
Bye. Goodbye.
Bye.
All right, hear it. Let's hear it. The quote. Fanculo. Fanculo. What a great song. It's David Johansson. Thank you very much, Redbird. Who was Dexter Poindexter?
It was meant to be. Tony Bruno of the Tony Bruno Sports Network. Bud Light presents Real Men of Genius.
Real Men of Genius.
Today we salute you, Mr. Professional Figure Skater.
Mr. Professional Figure Skater.
While lesser men strapped on skates and played hockey, you donned skin-tight leotards and a teeny cowboy hat and learned figure eights.
Going round and round.
You practiced and practiced, hoping, knowing, someday you'd be good enough to wear a giant puppet costume and skate in an ice show.
Welcome to the big time.
Skate perfectly and you're a crowd pleaser. Mess up and fall on your butt, and you're still a crowd pleaser. So crack open an ice-cold Bud Light, oh Titan of the Tights. You may never wear a medal, but sequins are shiny, too.
Mr. Professional Figure Skater.
Bud Light Beer, Anheuser-Busch, St. Louis, Missouri.
Now back to the biggest sports network on the planet, the Tony Bruno Sports Network.
And the land is dark and the moon.
Yes, stand by me. But not too close, biatch. We ain't that close.
No, I won't.
Tony, the Prince, Prince.
Onaj.
Onaj KZ. Says, Tony, you always have Luigi on. When are you going to bring his brother Mario on? You know, Luigi has a brother named Mario.
Yes, he does.
Did you know that?
His real brother's name is Mario. And his brother, they're now since divorced, used to be married to a woman named Daisy.
That's exactly right.
Yes.
And so I think I told him many times he should sue. What's the company that runs the Mario Brothers? Who runs their?
Was it Nintendo?
I think it was. Yeah, Nintendo was the Mario Brothers and all the Mario all the Mario stuff.
Joshua Libby Trucker says, "I remember listening to you Into the Night, Tony Bruno show on Fox Sports Radio."
Yes. I'm not under the weather. People are saying I've only used a couple of tissues today. I don't know why. Pollen is in the air here all year round. So that's one thing about living in a place where flowers always grow. You don't go through that season where things start blooming and then everybody has hay fever, and that's normal. I don't know why I'm sniffling today. Maybe I have the newest situation going on, and it's big in Europe right now.
Now
I'm not talking about
in Italy,
Euro
especially.
Trash. So it's big in Italy?
Especially Italy right now.
Wow. It's parrot fever. We have a parrot fever update, and it has nothing to do with Jimmy Buffett at Margaritaville. It's a real parrot fever, and it's running wild. Let's go to your parrot desk. We need to have a little, although this is a serious ailment,
yeah,
Robin.
This is, we're,
we can't play any
even,
Jimmy Buffett in the back?
No, I don't think that's appropriate.
How about Yo-Ho, Yo-Ho, a pirate's
died.
Life from me?
People have died.
People have died from parrot disease?
Yes, they have.
Parrot fever? Is it worse than jungle fever?
Let's go to...
Where are we going? Italy?
Well, it's kind of all of Europe, but mostly Italy. So let's go to Italy first.
Let's go to Italy. You just played Vaffanculo. We could say that to parrot fever.
Yeah, we could.
Because we want it to go away. I hope it's not spreading, Robin, and I hope I don't have it.
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
But it is a deadly outbreak of psittacosis.
What?
Which is an infection known as parrot fever. It is a bacterial fever, which is good because it's better than viral. Bacterial means that you can take antibiotics. But it has affected people living in several European countries, mostly in Italy right now. The outbreak was initially noted in 2023, and there have been 5 reported deaths so far.
I'm not laughing at that, but I mean, people, when you hear pirate fever, you know, the wise guys and the wise gals out there, what are they going to say?
I don't know.
Like, is it worse? I mean, Joey B. like my, is it worse than jungle fever? And listen, who hasn't had jungle fever? Seriously.
I mean.
And boogie fever, of course, by the Jackson 5. Remember that?
Now,
did parrot fever originate in the tiki, 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 tiki room at Walt Disney World Resorts?
It may be because, you know, you can get your freaky on in there if there's
in
not.
The tiki,
yeah.
Tiki, tiki,
but,
tiki,
did you
room?
Know that parrot fever is caused by a bacteria in the chlamydia family?
No, I didn't even know they were related. Well, chlamydia does end in a vowel, so it's got to be Italian.
So,
and you know, the Italians always make good
Now, this is
diseases.
Infected birds don't always seem sick.
But the hungry birds eat, though. That's what I want to know.
But they shed bacteria when they both breathe or poop. Also, you can get sick if a bird, like a parrot, bites you. So no beak to mouth contact, Tony.
Well, what about beak to ass? I mean, can you do that? No. Never go beak to ass.
No. No beak. No beak to mouth. Because, you know, like a lot of people, they kiss their birds.
Yeah, who doesn't?
Yeah.
I used to have a parrot and I would kiss them. Did you see this one video on X today? I don't know how old it is, but it's a guy with a parrot who just bought a parrot from somebody else.
Uh-huh.
And the parrot's sitting on a perch, right, on a wooden perch. And the cage is on the ground. And the guy gets a sledgehammer and starts destroying
the cage
because the bird hated the cage.
Okay.
And then the bird is up on the perch. And as this guy is smashing the cage, the bird is uttering profanities, the F word, over and over and over again.
That's
awesome. The bird is cursing at the cage because this guy freed that bird.
I like this. Chlamydia. Come on. Let's get it back to lipstick talk already. Thanks, Darby. Now, here's the good news.
Angry Birds, no. Yeah,
here's the good news. Human-to-human transmission is possible, but very rare.
So you first have to have sex with a bird or have a bird poop on you or kiss you, bird?
So
who doesn't want their bird to kiss you?
Most of the cases, people have been exposed to domesticated or wild birds that were infected. So most people who get parrot fever will only have a mild illness.
Is there a vaccine yet from Dr. Fauci?
The symptoms are headache, muscle pain, dry cough, fever, and chills. Antibiotics can treat the infection, and it's rarely fatal.
What were the symptoms again?
You're going to get it now.
Maybe that's why I'm. Maybe that's why, Robin, because there's a lot of birds here. There's a lot of birds here in Florida. Maybe I had, you know, because they poop on you all the time when you don't know it. We had a. What was the bird that pooped on us last year going up to
almost
its nest?
An osprey.
An osprey was up there.
Yeah.
And everybody, look at the beautiful osprey in its nest. And then he flies and he just poops. And I mean, it's
shot out of his ass.
Shot through the heart. Not bird in hand, Pennsylvania. No. That's a different place.
No, and J.M. Ramsey, good question. No,
it's not the bird flu.
It is not the bird flu because the bird flu is a virus. This is a bacterial infection, and so you can take antibiotics, which is very good.
This is how sick Joey B is. Two birds, one cup? No.
Oh,
I don't think you can get it if there's two birds and one cup. Oh, my God.
Our listeners are sick. You guys are sick MFers, and we love you. Tony, we have a non-bird question.
Well, everybody knows about the bird. Bird is the word, Robin.
Red Bird. Oh, that's so sweet of you. Red Bird says, this bird would never poop on you, Robin. That's a fact.
Well, how do you know? We've been pooped on. You go to the beach and the seagulls, they poop when they can fly.
No, their handle is Red Bird.
Oh, Red Bird.
Get it straight, Tony.
Is he Native American or is he a Cardinals fan?
I don't know. I think, personally, I would like to think that he's just naming himself after me, which is a robin.
That's Robin Redbreast.
Yes.
Just eat green yogurt, our prince friend
Greek,
says.
Greek, not green.
Oh, Greek yogurt. I'm sorry. I thought it was green yogurt.
Can you put on some actual glasses
these
instead
are,
of the blue
these,
blockers?
They look good on me today. They're just basically blue blockers and ball blockers.
It is not
And
helping.
Cock blockers. I wear these as a cock blocker. Erica, not Red Robin, bottomless fry. By the way, we went into a Red Robin for the first time down here in Florida, and it was disappointing, Robin. Not you. Remember? And we ordered fries. Remember we ordered a burger because you were saying how great it was?
Yeah.
And we go in there. The burgers were good.
Yeah.
But then the fries were like cold.
Yeah, it wasn't very good.
That's an outrage.
It was an outrage. Erica 305 has a text coming in.
That's Miami, Robin.
Yep. Tony Bruno, love you, bro. Can you please help me digest and give your insight to what the hell my dolphins are doing on this releasing spree? Please talk me off the ledge. And then he continued with, Miss Robin is one badass babe. Why, thank you.
Dead.
Erica
Damn
305,
right.
You didn't, you need
Why
to
Why do you
sign.
Think I keep her employed and sheltered and fed?
So whoever 305 is, please make sure
that's
that
you Miami, Robin.
I know.
Benvenido a Miami.
If you texted that from 305 next time, make sure that you sign it with your name so that we can give you love.
Maybe that's one of the spring breakers hitting town, hitting the beaches.
It could be. Well, no, but then they wouldn't have 305 area code.
Well, people who live in Miami still go to the beach.
Well, that's true.
Not with all these stunads who come in from all over the country and then make stuff, bust up stuff, and then they get mad when they bring in extra police so that people's businesses don't get busted up. And I love today, I was watching all the people who were mad at Governor DeSantis for helping have police patrol Miami, Fort Lauderdale, the hotspots, and there's a lot of hotspots for spring breakers all over Florida, all over Texas. So the governor says, hey, you know what? The last couple of years, things got out of hand. Right, and we even played the PSA yesterday that the city of Miami put together, reminding them that, yes, we live here. People live in Miami, and the natives have had enough of people coming to their city. And listen, Miami's a party town all the time. And people go to Miami Beach and party all the time. But guess what? People don't go to Miami Beach and trash it every single weekend because people who live there respect it. They go on the beach. There are some knuckleheads everywhere. But as I mentioned the other day, they don't even start partying until like 10 or 11 o'clock at night on South Beach.
Yeah.
But the spring breakers, they're out there all day drinking. They bring in booze. They have their friends buy it for them. And listen, I was a teenager. I get it. Underage kids drink. But underage kids, when I was growing up, did not bust shit up. And if you've seen the videos and all the people who are mad that they're actually bringing law and order to Miami Beach to prevent businesses, you know, from having to shut down, having to charge people $100 to park. That's what the people are worried about. And most of these people who are complaining and calling DeSantis a Nazi,
it's so insane.
They don't own a business. They don't own anything. They don't own jack shit. They're the first people to complain if somebody came into their neighborhood and broke your door down. But if people who are running businesses don't want to have their businesses destroyed and have to close early, and we've seen it in Philly and a lot of other seasons, when you have big gatherings of Utes primarily at spring break, this is what happens. People can't handle their alcohol. You know, listen, I have no problem with wet T-shirt contests. If you're going to do wet T-shirt contest, let's just keep it to wet T-shirt contest. Everybody can agree. Even the guys can agree on wet T-shirt contest.
I do believe.
And guys, she'll like it too because they get paid a lot of money to win these things.
Yeah.
They're not doing it because, you know what I'm saying? Can we play a block of Pitbull? Yeah. Robin, we haven't played any Pitbull.
And you know, normally Martinez and Comedy comes on right
after.
Yeah,
and he plays the Pitbull.
And he plays the
Pitbull. I don't know about you, but I feel good.
That is one of the happiest. Like, is there any way that you
Are there any
to
downer Pitbull songs, Robin? Come on.
I don't think there's downer Pitbull.
Talk about Miami. Benvenidos a Miami. Not Hot Pockets, no. Not Red Rover, come on over. No. It's amazing that the people who hate law and order are the ones who don't give a shit about other people's property getting messed up. Why is that, Robin? Why is it that the people who get mad when cities and communities are trying to bring in by the way, did you see what the governor of New York, Kathy Hochul, announced today?
What did she announce?
And again, this isn't political. This is just what's happening in the real world. Apparently, she announced that she's going to bring in National Guard people, and I want to make sure I got this right because I don't want to misquote her. So I got to find this because I think if this is true, you talk about people absolutely changing their minds. The defund the police people are suddenly changing their tunes when it comes to what's going on in their neighborhoods.
Prince Onaj saying $100 to park. The hell? I don't even spend that much on groceries. I'm catching the bus. See, now, the $100 to park, I think that's a great idea because that forces people to not drink and drive. If they're driving down there, then there's a very good chance that they're going to get drunk and then get in their cars and drive home. And there's, I mean, every single year, there are accidents, there's deaths, there's damage, property damage. There's like, you name it, it's happening down there. And they're just trying to, you know, if you want to go down there and have a good time and respect the rules and you know, if you still want to drink, okay, fine, drink, but just don't get blitzed.
Just go into your hotel room.
Blotzoed.
Blotzoed? What the hell is that?
I think I'm trying to combine two or three different words at the same time.
Besotted? Tanked? Bombed?
I think I
What are the common terms?
Blitzed, blotted. But there's something called something sounding like blottoed, blah blah. I don't know.
I'm blasted, bombed,
bombed,
besotted. Besotted is an underused word, Robin. Besotted. Did you ever hear that word?
No, there's
besotted means.
Oh, I know
stone
that.
Stone cold drunk.
But there is another word that sounds like blotzoed, but that's not it. What's the word I'm looking for? People?
I don't know, Robin. Your definition of drunk, besotted is actually completely in love with someone. But I thought it also meant being drunk, besotted, blindly or utterly infatuated. I didn't know it was about that. I thought it was stupefied with drink, intoxicated. So it has multiple meanings, Robin. Infatuated or obsessed.
Yes.
But it also means someone who is absolutely stone cold drunk AF, right?
I mean, I've heard the word somebody is besotted over you.
Yes.
Yeah.
But it also means drunk is a skunk. And by the way, drunks do not get skunk. Where do you get drunk as a skunk from, Robin?
Are skunks known to get drunk?
Biazzo did play for the Canadiens.
Blottoed. So.
And by the way, we didn't give AJ Lopez a happy birthday greeting the other day. Wasn't it his birthday too?
No. Is it? No. It's AJ, AJ Johnson.
I know it's AJ. We gave him a happy birthday greeting.
No, we didn't.
Trashed is a good word too. But no, but AJ, the picture came up the other day on March 3rd, which was Sunday. And coincidentally, March 3rd of 2023 was also a Sunday. And that's the day, one of the days, when AJ Lopez from San Antonio and I were sitting at the ball yard watching baseball when Robin wasn't here. I think when you went, is that when you went to the Netherlands last March? When did you go there?
When I went to the Netherlands, Duncan Dad came down.
That's right. But this is when AJ came
AJ Lopez training. My birthday's in June.
That's so right. I don't think he's a Gemini. I think he's a Cancer right after it. I don't remember what his date. Mine's on the 13th.
Redbird says, a blotto is a drunk with liver spots.
Well, I mean, it happens to the best and the worst of us. You know what I'm saying? Trashed is a word, too. But AJ Lopez and I sitting there, I think it was at the Red Sox game. We were sitting there on March 3rd, exactly 1 year to the date. Coincidence? I think not. Meanwhile, we got to do this this latest trend thing, Robin. And you're a woman, and I can attest to that. But you transitioned to a really ruby red lip thing. But now here's something, and I'm going to ask you, Robin, because, you know, it's not that I'm an old guy. I get trends. I get women's trends. They come back, you know, stuff that was cool in the 50s came back for a while. Remember the hairdos, you know, and the stockings and the Betty Boop stuff and the what's her name? Betty Page. You know, all that lingerie stuff. And that never goes out in my book. But anyway, we now have a new trend that women are doing. And I don't get this. I'm going to ask you as a woman, Robin, do you get this? And can you explain it and put up some photos, please? This is our science segment. This is our science segment.
This apparently, it says that this is coming from Freckles Tattoo in Warsaw.
Is that in Poland?
I don't know if that means that it's in Poland.
There's Warsaws all over the country. There's cities in different states.
And these are women who are getting tattoos. So this is immediately.
It looks like they got, what's the stuff that there's? They have run all the commercials for? All the skin things where you get
rosacea?
The rash. No, the other one that there's like 50,000 cures. Psoriasis. Plaque psoriasis.
So now, obviously, this is immediately after they've gotten a tattoo. So they're all still red from having just gotten their tattoos. But
still.
They're getting freckles tattooed on their face.
I mean, I get a couple of freckles. But what chick, seriously, would you ever? Now, you have some natural freckles.
I have natural freckles.
Since when is it? Like, let's get 1,000 freckles on our face. And by the way, when you're getting these freckles, let's also get a septum ring while we're at it.
Well, she already had that.
No,
obviously.
But a couple of chicks have septum rings. Yeah. And get it. You know, I don't care what you do. But I don't. Do you know any woman? Would your daughter do this?
No.
She has freckles too.
She has freckles. She has natural freckles.
But look at how many they put on their faces.
I know. It's just bizarre.
It's like when you're 15 years old and your zits explode when you're going through puberty or when you're going through whatever chicks go through. Do they go through puberty too, Robin, when the chicks go into the zit stage?
Oh, hell yeah.
No, I thought puberty was just for guys. What's it called when chicks get zits all over their face? Okay.
It's puberty.
They should have a different term for women and men, Robin. We're not the same.
J.M. Ramsey, they look like they have parrot fever.
Parrot fever. Yes, as the great Philadelphia Public School says, nothing is everything. All these jingles for all these drugs.
Sky Rizzy.
I mean, I have never seen more people who have skin situations going on and so many drugs to cure it all. Is that just me, or do you notice that there's so many drugs for people with skin rashes and shit? And that's not the good shit. That's the bad shit.
It's a TikTok thing. This tattoo artists are placing permanent and semi-permanent freckle tattoos. It's just so bizarre. Like, I remember when I was growing up and I had tons of freckles. The whole point was to cover them up because it was people made fun of my freckles. Just think, I would have been so on fleek. I would have
You're
been
right,
on
Robin.
Trend.
You were way ahead of
I
your
was
time.
Way ahead of my time.
You're damn right. Now people are paying to get tattooed in their faces, and these are not easy to remove. I would think, right? Even though they're small dots, but imagine sitting there and say, "Yeah, no, you put a couple extra dots on this side. I think you went a little light up in my cheekbone area."
It's just bizarre,
dude. Dude, I'd rather have no. I don't want. I wouldn't rather have pirate fever.
Pirate fever.
Although I've you
what,
know.
What's pirate fever?
That's when you want to go on the Pirates of the Caribbean over and over again, and sing yo ho yo ho a pirate's life for me.
Tony, oh my goodness gracious! Look at
what the
time
show's
is
almost over
holy
already.
Crapola! How did this happen?
I don't know. It just flew by today, sort of like a parrot pooping on you.
Yes.
Or
now,
any
stay
other
tuned,
birds.
Stay tuned for Bleacher Brothers at 8 p.m. tonight. Unfortunately, Angel Martinez again out for the rest of this week. Mm-hmm. And then tomorrow morning starting at 7 a.m., it is the fabulous Pete Shepherd.
Pete Shepherd in the house, yo!
And then we have LFG from 1 to 3 before our show. And we're trying to get Defo back on and Angel back in the house.
Everything's going to be all right. Everything is going to be all right. Don't drink and drive, folks. Don't text and drive. Don't bust up shit if you're going out to a party or if you're going to South Beach or anywhere for spring break. Let's try to act a little civilized. That's why we're a civilization.
And make sure you tune back in tomorrow for the Tony Bruno Show at 3 p.m. Eastern right here on all the channels that you are now currently on.
Exactly right. Good night, everybody. We love you. And God bless America. It still is, at this hour, the greatest place on earth. Good night, and God bless.
You're listening to Tony Bruno Sports Network. Tony.
Say goodbye, Tony Bruno. You can talk.
Goodbye. Goodbye. Bye.